Blank Check with Griffin and David. Blank Check with Griffin and David. Don't know what to say or to expect. All you need to know is that the name of the show is Blank Check.
Here are my terms. Goest thou to hell and swiftly please, and there may Ozymandias himself suckle from your diseased podcast.
Great. Disease what? What's the word?
Teat.
Yeah.
Right. Osmodius?
Ozymandias?
It's not Ozymandias. Okay. It's Osmodius. Mm. You know, everyone's 17th favorite character.
17th favorite hell demon?
Yes. Hello, everybody. My name is Griffin Newman.
A lot of hell talk and you don't see hell.
No.
David Sims.
He's never made a hell movie, has he?
No. I mean, I don't think so.
Beetlejuice has the underworld.
Undead dimensions.
Yes.
But, no, I guess not. No. Sleepy Hollow has a hell tree.
Yeah, he has a lot of, like, portals to hell.
Right, right. But hell's over there.
Yeah, it's always in the neighborhood. It's right over your shoulder. My name is Griffin Newman.
You already said that. I'm David Sims.
I was trying to, like, cue you up so we could have a rhythm going. There's a podcast called Blank Check with Griffin and David. We're hashtag the two friends.
Thumbs up.
What we like to do is talk about filmographies.
Jamie, like that.
Directors who have massive success early in their careers have a series of blank checks given to them. Sometimes those checks clear.
Yeah.
And sometimes they bounce Ozymandias.
Okay. Ben just shook his head.
Jamie, we say we're the two friends. Every show has its own rules. I just like the guest to talk.
No, you can talk.
We are
you gotta cough.
The reason I say that we're the two friends is because that is our competitive advantage in the podcasting world.
Yeah, we're two friends.
The two friends, yeah. Because I'm telling it like it is a little bit.
A lot of podcast people talk about movies. You yourself host one, Bechdel Cast.
Yeah, I know.
Jamie Loftus is our guest today.
Yeah, just get right to it.
Podcaster, writer. And we were trying to figure out, like, okay, what makes us stand out in this landscape? And we went, oh, I know what it is. We're two friends.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And there's not a lot. It's usually two acquaintances.
Yeah.
Sure.
Two people.
Two coworkers.
Posing as friends.
Peers.
Three friends.
Right. Yeah, right.
Three lovers.
Oh.
Oh, God. Those ones are the worst.
Yeah.
I don't want to listen to a podcast recorded between lovers. I just don't.
No. And,
I don't.
What if that is that is? Are there lover podcasts?
100% are. There are a lot of like, especially.
Do they start with like, "How are you doing, lover?" Like that.
No,
like,
they talk about like they're like, "Oh my god, the milk at our house," and I was like, "I can't listen to your
right."
They're boring.
I'm not going to drag anyone by name, but there is an entire culture, and they're very successful. Of like two stand-ups who are married host a podcast together about.
Oh. There's at least one of those that I like.
There's like five of those.
There's one of those that I really like, and then the rest are about the milk at the house.
Right.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Do you want to say the one you like?
I mean, the one I like is Couples Therapy.
Oh, yeah.
With Naomi Ekperigin.
Oh, they're great.
And Andy Beckerman.
They are great. I have not heard that. They are great.
Well, there used to be a Minaj, but they're done.
Yes.
That was a couple. That was a couple pod. Yes. That was a Ben pod.
Oh, yeah.
Is that Ben pod?
But they don't, yeah.
No, I used to produce a show called Ménage à Trois.
Producer Ben used to host a show called Ménage à
Trois. With Murph Meyer and Diana
Ben Deucer, Purdue Ben, the poet laureate.
We would talk to guests about their sex lives.
Keeper.
It was fun.
Tiebreaker.
I was on it once.
Yeah?
Poet laureate.
I guess I talked about my sex
Meat
life
lover, the fart detective.
I was single at the time, so I was like more interested.
You're down to reveal.
Yeah, I was like, yeah, let's talk about it, guys.
Podcasting whilst single is a slippery slope.
It is.
See me in the sheets.
Yeah. And then the people like listen to it and they're like, I heard you on thing. And you're like, yeah.
Yeah, I've been kind of revealing too much about my life.
He's not professional.
Ben's single right now. Congrats.
And then your crush finds it, and then they're like, "Oh, you're gross."
Or if you have a crush on me, that's what you find out.
If I can say two things,
depends.
Though,
right.
One thing,
You've been single on this podcast for stretches. You've had some single stretches.
I'm single most of the time.
Right. Yeah, I was trying to finesse that.
Yeah, thank you. I was gonna say this probably will have come up in an earlier episode. We're recording things out of order. The way we became friends
with being single.
Well, yes, but also we both on Ménage à Trois listed the same pop culture crush.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. You're right. And of course, it was.
And
it was,
people, it was
same first pop culture crush.
Same first, like, pop culture crush. Wait, Lydia Deetz and Beetlejuice.
And Beetlejuice. Oh, okay.
And people said, "Do you guys know you had the same answer? You should be friends with each other."
Right. Right. That's
you should
right.
be two friends with each other.
Should be, and then you're like, "Hey, there's something to this."
Yeah.
This two? Whole two friends, friends? Idea. Okay.
We're onto something.
Hold
here.
On.
It smells like oil. Yeah, no, but I mean, you know, you had been reluctant to do Tim Burton on this podcast, and I had to wear you down over a series of years. I had to rope-a-dope you.
Sure.
But you realize he was one of the things that kind of brought us together. And then the second thing I want to say is that producer Ben has graduated to a series of titles over the course of different movies, such as Kylo Ben, producer Ben Kenobi, Ben I. Shyamalan, Ben Sayed, Save Anything, dot, dot, dot. Illy Benz with a dollar sign, Warhaz, Purdue Urbane. Benglish,
these are all like puns
Mr.
on like
Ben Credible, Ben 19, the
oh, okay.
Fettlemaker,
so he's
Drink,
like giving me
Ben
a
Hosley.
For everyone.
What's Nancy, though?
Do you like it?
The Hosliday.
Not really. It's fine.
You could take it or leave it.
Yeah.
It's just the listing off, and I'm like, okay.
Here it goes.
You would be astounded to hear that people were angry when I dropped it from the show.
Ooh.
Yeah, we were like, look, the name thing takes so long. The guests are so confused by it. Can we stop doing it?
I don't enjoy doing
right.
it.
Right. Griffin was sick of doing
but
it.
Then and it turns out that's, yeah. I hate when apparently, you drop one thing and then it turns out that was the only thing people ever cared about.
Right. Our listenership
plummeted.
We have a Beetlejuice segment that I do every time we do a show, which is, does Beetlejuice come wet scabs or dry scabs? Right. And... I was sick of saying it because it does make me feel sick to say.
Sure, it's,
yeah.
Right.
But then when I stopped, people got
upset.
People
were upset.
Yeah.
You know, look, we have so little to offer people, and I'm glad that they enjoy the names and the scabs and whatever that we can
you
offer.
You gotta
people.
Give them that. Yeah.
Yes.
Are you a Beetlejuice fan? What is sort of your like relationship
your Burton,
to Tim Burton,
Burton
in general? Because I feel like everyone's got a strong Tim Burton stance, one way or the other.
Oh, I've been in and out on Tim Burton. I used to be strong into TB. I was like actively trying to date Hot Topic managers.
Cool.
Knew my TB.
Yes.
Back to front. Sort of. Almost like not even because I really liked it, but because
it was just kind of like crucial.
I wanted to, date this skateboarder who was the assistant manager at Hot Topic.
Right. And it was like
so
him 101.
There was a specific guy.
Right.
There was a specific
guy. That was your type, but also there was one sort of.
There was one. Yeah. I mean, there was kind of two. There was a lot of skateboarder boys, and I wanted to date all of them. And they would all work at the Hot Topic.
Yeah.
And so I didn't realize till recently, I thought I had seen Nightmare Before Christmas. Not true. I have just been to a Hot Topic. I thought that
you've
seen
it on sweatshirts. Like you've seen sort of like a picture book. If you like look through a Hot Topic, you can see half the movie.
And after a while, I was just like, I've seen this movie.
Right.
I will say that is one of those movies that like you take a stopwatch to it. It's actually like 67 minutes long before credits.
Very short. I mean, it was hard to make.
Probably have seen the entire movie through merchandise. Honestly, that movie is so short that you probably have seen it represented. Across all the different items they sell there.
Well, with that, it's like everyone's pushing the whole Jack Sally thing, but they're in three scenes together, and in two of them, he's actively negging her.
Yeah, he's not nice.
He's like, "Shut up and make my suit." Like I was like, "This is the sweatshirt moment." Unbelievable.
I'm a big fan of that movie. I don't think it works best as a love story.
Right.
No.
But it is weird how that movie has just become this thing that's like picked apart and people use to represent whatever like in their dark soul they want. Yeah. Reflected back to them.
It's a good AIM away. Like, that used to be like an AIM away message, like, looking for the Jack to my Sally.
Well, and there was that Blink-182 song that was like, it would be like Jack and Sally.
Oh my God.
Do you remember they used that?
Oh, I forgot about that.
I feel like
totally
that was a moment that crystallized it as like,
yes.
Right.
That's so icky.
I think that was a moment, though, because that was sort of like, what? The movie, it's been like 25 years since the movie came out. This was the anniversary.
Jack 93. And Sally.
Be like Jack and Sally.
Oh God, I feel sick. There is 93.
Yeah, right. So 25 years.
Right. I feel like you know, 10 years in, 2003, you said, right, 2003, I think is when it went from being like, okay, the movie was like marginal when it came out, then it became a cult success, and then it became like
a sweatshirt.
A mainstream cult
success. Just sort of a canonical generational thing.
Right.
Everyone had seen it when they were a kid and they were all grown up now and they were all like, yeah, that's a tradition, that movie.
Right.
Yeah.
And then that Blink-182 song was around that time, which is when Hot Topic becomes like 99% Nightmare Before Christmas merchandise.
This is when we are all teenagers.
I owned a Jack Skellington sweatshirt. convinced cool. I had seen the movie. Well, I just saw the movie for the first time a couple days ago.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Really? Wow. Yeah.
We just did an episode on it and I thought I had seen the movie.
I think the fact that like the merchandise still felt like edgy because the movie, like people didn't fucking get it when it came out.
Oh, it's like skeletons and bones, dude.
He's like a skeleton man. Yeah. So
imagine a regular man, but a skeleton. It's pretty cool.
My favorite thing is to call all skeletons skeletons.
Skeletons. Right.
But Disney marketing machine like amped it up, and then the kids were like, I don't like that fucking cookie cutter Disney stuff.
Sure.
I like this other sweatshirt produced by Disney.
And we really showed them by purchasing those sweatshirts.
They became like the alt Jack and Rose. You know, if you're like, I'm not basic. I don't like that fucking Titanic shit.
I do.
I like the twisted.
Can I get a Jack and Rose sweatshirt?
100%.
Are those available? That would be great.
I feel like Hot Topic now, like all the stuff that Hot Topic used to stand for has become so mainstream that the way they could go back around to being alt is to take the things that used to be the most mainstream and reclaim them as cult.
They should do that.
Right, to just like go all in on like My Best Friend's Wedding or whatever.
Because their
like,
stores are now like Nightmare Before Christmas, Deadpool, and Harley Quinn. God. Which are like so universally popular.
Right.
I can't even. Deadpool gives me a migraine. I can't deal with it.
Well,
to be fair, that's what I was going to say. It hurts your head a little bit to think about the fact that he knows that he's in a movie.
It's true. I mean, when he gives us the little look and we know he's in on the joke, I'm like, oh my God, this is too. There was someone I was briefly dating who saw Deadpool 2 so many times.
Congratulations.
What? So many times is two.
more than two times.
And this is also recent history.
Yeah, right.
It was in the past couple months.
Yeah, clearly.
We're no longer together.
Okay. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. There's sometimes
red
flags.
Did he know he was in a relationship?
He was like, Jamie, there's actually, so say what you will, but there's actually some really good cutaway jokes or like some good, oh no, some really top-notch fourth wall breaks. I was like,
was he trying to like appeal to you as like, Jamie, you're like a comedian, you need to see like due diligence.
Deadpool was his favorite comedian.
Wow.
Which is something that he said.
Do you think Deadpool
there was something going for this guy, right? Was he like a Rhodes Scholar?
Was he a Hot Topic manager?
Did he have like a Nobel Prize and something?
He was a very specific type that I go for regardless of where your brain's at.
Right.
And so he
physical
was
type,
a,
you're
a
saying?
Big physical type.
Gotcha.
Was
Skellington.
Just and we're like good, we're good friends still, sure. But you know, there were some
there were some hangups like Deadpool was his favorite
Deadpool was his favorite comedian, which hurt me personally. Mm-hmm. And also I am not sure if he knows Deadpool is not a real man who exists. I think he does, but he doesn't speak of Deadpool as if he's a fictional character.
It is crazy that Deadpool was never on Herald Night. It's kind of crazy that he never made a
new
house
faces.
Team.
Right.
He sailed through. He sailed right through.
Yeah.
True. I mean, raw talent.
Yes.
He does teach a class, though, right?
He does, but it's more of like a storytelling class. So it's one of those UCB classes where the getting the credit doesn't help you.
No, you got to do it just because you love it.
Yeah.
You love it.
Deadpool's cool. Are we all going to see the PG-13 Deadpool recut that's coming out of Christmas? Should we make a date?
David, by the time this episode comes out, it will have been released three months ago.
I will have seen it many times.
On the record, it changed the world. Deadpool is president now.
Deadpool is president.
Right, that was it. That was the crucial thing he needed to break the dam.
Deadpool is daddy.
Yeah.
So was there a point for you, because I find there are, you know, most people, especially of our generation, like Tim Burton growing up.
Mm-hmm.
And then there are the people like myself who like, it's like the ex you can't get over. I still keep on giving him another shot.
Sure.
And the people like David where it's like, I can't deal with it anymore.
Oh, I'm fully done.
Okay.
I'm fully done. So I loved Edward Scissorhands. That was my Tim Burton.
That's your primo ultimate number.
Yes.
My question is, because I find it's different for people, what was your like point of no return? What was the one where you just went like, fuck this?
God, I'd need to
Let me run you down some Burts. So, you know, you got your early Burts. You know, you got your Pee-wee, your Beetlejuice, your Edward, your Batman.
Miracle Run.
Edward.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then we're in the sort of 90s Burts. Yeah. We got Mars Attacks, Sleepy Hollow.
Still there.
Planet of the Apes with Wahlberg.
I haven't seen that one.
Fine. Easy to skip over.
Terrible.
Big Fish.
Didn't love Big Fish, but stayed with him.
Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, and now we're getting into the Dark Shadow Zone, the sort of Johnny Depp star vehicle zone.
I was the right age at Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, so I was still
on board.
Still there.
Then we got Corpse Bride, Sweeney Todd.
Still there.
2010, though, Alice in Wonderland.
That's where I'm gone.
Right. And so that, his biggest hit ever.
I haven't seen it.
You know, it's not so good.
No, it's a bad movie. It's a very bad movie, and it's a thing that kind of dooms him that it was that successful.
It was that successful, it cost that much, and it starred Johnny Depp. So I guess he was sort of like, I guess I need to do really expensive things that star Johnny Depp. Like, is that the move for me? Like,
Right.
Because he follows up with Dark Shadows.
Yeah.
And I guess he hasn't worked with Depp since Dark Shadows.
No.
Yeah.
No, that's the last one for now.
Oh God! Is there like something on the horizon?
Forever. I don't know.
It does seem like there's been some kind of a
schism.
Yeah, like they.
Well, we also know that Tim Burton seems very willing to forgive bad people for doing bad things.
Wait, who else are we talking about?
Well, I'm talking about how he basically is like, I love white people, like how he's kind of like a low key white supremacist. So I don't really trust his moral compass. I think he would cast Johnny Depp again and again.
Hey, so David, we're actually in my apartment currently.
That's right. We are.
We're in a small fine. That's what I like to call it.
Medium okay.
Medium okay. Yeah.
Regular. Just called regular.
It's regular.
Welcome to regular.
Regular. So anyway, I wanted to tell the listeners about Stamps.com.
Oh, Stamps.com. They're friends of the show.
They are. So Stamps.com brings all the amazing services of the U.S. Postal Service right to your computer.
That's true.
Whether you're a small office sending invoices, an online seller shipping out products, or even a warehouse sending thousands of packages a day, Stamps.com can handle it all with ease.
I know about Stamps.com. You can use your computer to print official postage for any letter, any package, any class of mail, anywhere you want to send it. You just hand it to your mail carrier or you drop it in a mailbox. It's that simple.
With Stamps.com, you get 5 cents off every first class stamp and up to 40% off priority mail. Stamps.com is a no-brainer. It's saving you time and money. It's no wonder over 700,000 small businesses already use Stamps.com.
Now, we have a Stamps.com account.
We do.
Here at Blank Check.
Yes.
So you were just telling me off mic. You're a regular.
Ooh, I'm going to tease a little enterprise I got cooking up.
Right.
So, Stamps.com, when you sign up, provides you with a free digital scale.
Oh, yeah. And a 4-week trial.
Right.
Free postage. And you don't even need to make a long-term commitment.
And so what I'm going to be doing with our Stamps.com account is I'm going to be making limited edition t-shirts for Blank Check.
Right.
I will do like a run of 50 shirts. And so sometime in the
stuff you can't get anywhere else.
Exactly. Yes. Handmade by this crazy person.
Truly demented shirt art.
And I promise I will probably throw in yes.
Shirt art is shart.
Yeah, that's good.
Thank you.
All right. Well, you hear it first. Wait, that wasn't
Ben
a word.
Shart. You hear first.
You hear first.
All right, go on.
So anyway, that'll be something that's happening very soon. I'm
going to
throw cigarette butts in the box too. Like there'll be weird stuff in there too. You know what I mean? It's like a whole curated.
Butts?
Well, it's a whole curated experience. Yeah, so anyway, that's something to look forward to. All right. So how could people though get their own Stamps.com subscription, David?
Well, right now our listeners can get a special offer that includes a 4-week trial plus free postage and a digital scale without any long-term commitment. You just got to go to stamps.com, click on the microphone at the top of the homepage, and type in check. Let's go to stamps.com and enter check. Click on that microphone.
You gotta.
This movie is like a couple of things coalescing at once. One is that, like, Johnny Depp has fully become the guy who, like, has Burton's checkbook and is like, do you mind if I go write a check under your name and then we just make it?
Right. Mm.
And this was, like, the first time that Depp comes to Burton and is like, this is a specific thing I want to do.
Oh, okay.
Yes, this was
that.
Depp's passion project, 100%. Not Burton's, which is funny. Depp was obsessed with the show.
Yes.
When he was a little kid.
Fun show.
Right. And so that was, like, I guess, one of his iconic, like, sort of hoped for roles, right?
Like, this is like, his, like, series of, like, 4 horrible flops in a row that kill his career before he starts also being a horrible person on top of that.
Right.
And the cornerstone of this period is Johnny Depp now has the capital to play all the characters he wanted to play when he was a kid. So it's like he idolizes Hunter S. Thompson. Right. He does another Hunter S. Thompson movie. He does Rum Diary.
Oh, God. I saw that movie by accident once.
Did you just order a rum? And they were like, yeah, through here.
It was at a movie theater it was the movie theater's fault.
Showed you the wrong movie.
And they were like, you can stay or you can...
They literally put the wrong thing on the projection.
I forget. That was what, like...
It's 2011. Yeah.
I don't know. I was not trying to see the Rum Diary. And it was like a few minutes in. I was like, this isn't what I don't know where, I don't know where I was. But then I saw the whole movie by accident.
And how was it?
It was really bad.
Yeah, I have not seen the Rum
Diary.
Yeah.
Not a good one.
Really bad.
Real bad.
Barnabas Collins and Tonto were his two favorite characters as a child.
Oh, right. God.
Wanted to play them. Right. And then he caps it off with Mordecai, who is his modern favorite character. He's like, I love these books. I got to make Mordecai.
Right.
And
Mordecai is, that's like, that doesn't even make any money. So that's like the final nail. Right. Where they're like, you can't pick projects anymore, John.
Then he's Cook.
John.
Mordecai.
Because after that is when he starts being like, if you want to murder me on an Orient Express, I'll do it. Like, whatever. Like, I need the cash.
Yes, he starts
becoming... wine guy is going to break my legs.
Right. He starts becoming a monster who, like, devours cash and eats souls. Yes.
Lives in the Dark Shadows mansion.
That, like, that horror... Was that, like, that a Rolling Stone piece?
Fucking, like, where it's basically, him being, like... Look, you might not be hearing from me much longer.
It's
a nightmare.
I love that piece.
There's a part of that piece that's one of the best of entertainment profile writing I've ever seen, where it says, like, Johnny announces, you know, in the room where it's like his lawyer, his bodyguard, and his chef, like the only people he hangs out with are the people who work for him.
Right. Yeah.
He never leaves his castle, right? And he says, like, hey, if we're going to have dinner, we need to have some wine first.
Uh-huh.
And then there's paragraph break, one sentence, which is just 12 hours later, we had still not started dinner.
Jesus Christ.
It's like horrifying.
He is like a parody. I know we're talking a lot of Depp on this miniseries.
We're going to have to.
This is the final Depp, so I guess salute, Depp.
Wow.
Fuck off. Yeah. But like, he is like, when I was a kid, you know, it's like, oh yeah, Johnny Depp, he's like cool, he's like lives in France, he's like on a boat, you know, he's like, hey,
he's a cool guy,
like Hunter Thompson and fucking whatever, smoking weed, like he was like seen as sort of like, oh yeah, he's not Hollywood, you know, and now he's like a parody of a Hollywood star. Like,
I was gonna say, I think I might have made this joke during this
Twisted and Evil
episode. Yes,
yeah,
I think I might have made this joke in the Sleepy Hollow episode, but he feels like the person that you remember as being so dreamy when you were like 17. Then you look at the yearbook and you're like, this person's a fucking joke.
Yeah,
you know, like the person you have a crush on when you're young.
You see him at the reunion and he's like, hey, how you doing? You want wine? You know, you're like, oh God,
sloshing his own bottle of wine.
But, I know you had a crush on me back in 1989. You're
meant to make your dreams come true.
Right. But this is like the moment where we don't realize that he's a war criminal. And when he goes to like his two favorite directors and he's like, Gore Verbinski, we're doing Lone Ranger, Tim Burton, we're doing Dark Shadows. And he like makes those two movies happen. And this was very much a thing where like Tim Burton was like, yeah, I used to watch the show like a little bit. Johnny was a big fan. He really wanted to do it. He like got me hired. And it feels like the impetus for this project being made was that Johnny Depp wanted to play Barnabas Collins, and that was where the ideas stopped.
And, like, Tim Burton's the director for Goths at this point.
Right. Like, this movie feels like hat on a hat, like him overdoing it.
Right.
It's weird that he did it. It's one of the movies that our friend Alex Ross Perry says feels like is directed by a shitty film school, like, protege of Tim Burton's rather than Tim Burton.
Right.
Where he would like see the trailer and he'd be like, what like B grade Tim Burton knockoff directed this movie?
Right.
And then you're like, oh fuck,
it
was
Tim Burton.
No.
Right. Yeah.
But you're a big fan of the show.
I really liked the show. Yeah. Right. My mom would show us episodes when we were little.
So we're all like total neophytes in this realm, which is why I was very excited. We threw out the flyer to you of like any of these you want to talk about, and you said, like, you know, I like Pee Wee. You might have said you liked another one. You were like, I would love to poop on Dark Shadows.
I love
that.
Was your
exact same. I would love to poop on that movie.
Well, my mom and my aunts were very excited to see it because
when you heard about this movie, you were like, awesome. Like, they're doing Dark Shadows. That's great.
It's weird because it's like I've seen so many episodes of Dark Shadows, but it was just sort of like the background track to my house a lot of the time. And so like we grew up with Barnabas and with the show. And my mom had like a whole stack of VHS where she would tape the old ones. I think they were like re-air on Sci-Fi or something.
Yeah.
And, you know, we hadn't been watching them for a while. And then when the movie came out, my mom, like all moms must, was like violently horny for Johnny Depp too. So this was like, we were going to see it. Like I came home from college to see it with her, and she would have been mad if I saw it without her. So
it is funny how he became like a mom crush in the 2000s. Like,
I mean, Pirates of the Caribbean, though,
starting with, right. Just, like, you know, cause and Shakala was sort of the like preview of Depp, as you know,
that's
where he's
a
like
great
the
Melina
guitar.
Joint.
Right, he stops being a hip crush.
Great Melina joint.
It's one of my fave Melina joints.
Isn't Melina a dick in that one? He's like the guy who's like, there shouldn't be chocolate. I hate it.
Yeah, he's
too sweet.
He's anti Shakala, but then you know he learns a little something about himself.
He does.
Melina is your top hunk, right? You're mad for Melina.
Yeah, I'm crazy for Melina.
What did I just see Melina in? He'll pop up in the weirdest fucking things.
Oh, yeah. And I'll say, oh, no, what are you going to say? I'm sorry.
He's just a gifted man. He can do it.
Okay. He can do anything.
He could play pro Shakala. He could play anti Shakala.
He could play like the Shakala mayor's like twin who's like, but I love chocolate.
He could play
like,
the Shakala itself. He's a gifted man and we love him.
Sweet as chocolate.
Yeah.
The thing I was going to say about him that I like about him, what you were saying, David, about him just like showing up in things, is I feel like he's one of those guys who's like storied career, very well known, very respected. Doesn't seem to have any ego and is like, yeah, I'll show up and do this for 2 days. It seems like a fun project.
He's in like 4 movies a year because he's just sort of like, let's do it.
And not as a surprise cameo and not as like uncredited, but he's just like, I'll be 17 on the call sheet.
It's Front Runner, in which he plays.
He has a big part in that, right?
Not really. No one has a big part in that. Okay. He plays Ben Bradley.
Oh, right.
And he's odd casting because Ben Bradley is like a Boston Brahmin, you know, kind of like.
How's he do?
He's fine. He's in the office. He's like, look. It used to be that the newspapers did this, and now they do this. I mean, what can I tell you? And then cut.
Alfred
you know.
Molina playing someone from Boston is my wet dream. That's very exciting. Yeah.
I'm sorry. There's not enough of him then, I would say. That's but still.
True. I mean, as long as he's there. He shows up. You get the feeling you're like, Alfred Molina is on time.
He rolls up his sleeves. He seems like a consummate pro.
Yeah.
Do you have like a top Molina for you?
What's your number one Molina?
He's got so much range. I wonder if there's like one or if there are a couple that for you like are your holy trinity maybe.
Well, I mean, Shakala is a classic Molina.
Wow. So it's near the top. Okay.
Loved him in Feud. He was terrific in Feud.
He was in Feud.
Yes.
Yeah. He played Robert Aldridge.
He did. Mm-hmm. Yes. And very well, might I add. And a lot of smoking hot Molina kissing scenes.
Which are sometimes, you know, few and far between.
Yeah.
You don't get a lot
of Molina kissing.
No.
He's good in Frida.
He was in Frida. That was he's a heartthrob in Frida. That's not one of my top. I mean, Doc Ock was the one that set me aflame as a child.
He's shirtless for most of that movie.
True.
Yeah.
Well, sort of like.
Yeah. No.
But his pants like go to his nipples. He's got high pants above the belly, and
he's got a long trench coat on. But he's not wearing a shirt.
He's leading with pecs.
Doc Ock was like a big moment for me.
Really?
I had a poster in my room, and I think my parents were like, "Oh, Jamie likes comic books."
Right.
But it wasn't.
Is it that one where it's
Alfred
like the arms and he's sort of like standing?
It was
like,
the one where he's looking over his shoulder and he's got his little. And it's great.
He's an intellectual. He liked poetry.
He was such a weird choice for that role, and he like destroyed it. Like
it's
good. It's amazing.
He's just what a gift.
All those scenes where he's talking to him. You know, his arms.
My best friend saw him play Tevye. I wish I saw him play Tevye.
I remember that.
Yeah. I tried really hard to run into him once. I just let him walk right by me. I got too scared.
Wow. Have you seen the Fiddler on the Roof Doc Ock video that was an Easter egg on the Spider-Man 2 DVD?
No.
Because I think he was rolling straight from Spider-Man 2 production into Fiddler on the Roof. They were like...
Got it.
Back to back. So he was like working on his Tevye while he was shooting. He would like practice it a lot. And there's
range.
There's B-roll footage with the arms that they have as an Easter egg where he's in. I think it's when he's in the, when he breaks into the coffee shop.
Oh, that's a
great walking scene. On the tentacles, right? He's like elevated above the ground. and he starts doing If I Was a Rich Man with the tentacles, and the puppeteers are like helping him do it with the tentacles.
Oh, that's great.
It's glorious. He just seems like such a pleasure to have in class.
Yeah. Like, that's just Alfred Molina.
Have you
all
seen Love is Strange? I'm sure you have.
I haven't.
That's Jamie.
Oh, that is like primo Molina that you need to check out. It's a little indie movie from like 5 years ago.
Alfred Molina, 4 years ago. John Lithgow, married in love, fighting for their rights.
Stop! Yep.
Just a nice, cute little couple who want the same rights as everyone else.
Oh my God.
Molina's a music teacher.
He's, of course.
Lithgow's a novelist or something.
Oh, and he gets fired because they find out.
I know.
No.
Oh,
that he's a gay man.
God.
The fact that they're getting married. Before, there was sort of plausible deniability. He's just your roommate.
Right, it was sort of a don't ask, don't tell thing.
Now that you're married.
It's a great, sad movie, and Molina's the best part of it. And it's
so
like
good.
Sad, happy movie. You know, it's like a good,
bittersweet,
bittersweet movie.
It's sort
very,
of like a
very
bittersweet
nice.
Chuckle.
The range. He recently, I found his Finsta.
What? This is real?
Not what I expected you to say.
He has a Finsta?
He has a Finsta, and he saw Frozen on Broadway recently.
Shit.
He travels quietly.
Wow. Molina. In and out.
We're avoiding talking about Dark Shadows for good reason. But
he should be in now. I'm just mad he's not in Dark Shadows.
He would. Oh, I think he. I always have theories that he was offered it and rejected
it.
He
was like, absolutely not.
It was like, oh, no.
What was the thing I was going to say about Molina before we move on from Molina?
I don't know.
Oh, no. It was about the Frozen musical. I just want to say this one thing.
Oh, yeah.
Have you seen that the tagline for the Frozen musical is, you've never seen Frozen like this?
No.
I've seen those ads, yeah.
Which is like,
SNL.
Right, yeah, we've only seen Frozen the one way.
Frozen's like 3 years old.
It's not like saying you've never seen Hamlet like this, where it's like, well, I've seen 20 Hamlets, so if it's new, that's a real selling point.
Right, yeah. It's the second way to see it.
Right, you've never seen Frozen like this. You mean not 110 minutes in CGI animated?
You mean not shown to make a child be quieter?
Right. So anyway, you had never seen Dark Shadows like this before you had seen this movie.
No, and I mean, there's no turning back once you see this Dark Shadows.
Now, the TV show was a soap opera. Like, it aired 5 days a week.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, most of the episodes of Dark Shadows are bad.
And they're like 2,000 episodes. There's an insane episode count.
There's a million episodes. All of them are like, whatever, like they're all very short. Most of the stories, I couldn't like direct you to a specific episode of Dark Shadows, but sure. I've seen hundreds of them.
So your investment is more in sort of the thing as a whole than it is like you were so invested in these plot lines, these characters, these arcs.
No, right. I mean, there's really, like most soap operas, there were no, storylines that were worth getting into.
They were making it up as they went along.
Turned it up. Yeah, right. It was five episodes a week. But it was great. I loved Barnabas.
Mm-hmm.
And even like when this movie was announced, Johnny Depp felt like, it felt forced to be like, he's Barnabas. I don't really think he's going to do a good job. And then sure enough, he did not do a good job.
But it was one of those things where, like, I think people went like, oh, they like can't get Dark Shadows made unless you have a star as big as Johnny Depp. And it was like, no, it's like the only reason this movie's being made is because Johnny Depp wants to play Barnabas. Like, I don't think this would have gotten made otherwise. I don't think Warner Brothers was itching to make a Dark Shadows movie.
And it's not like Dark Shadows was like, that was something that a lot of people were like, when's the movie going to happen?
It's
like the General Hospital, the movie. That's not going to, like, although I would.
I'd watch.
Its differentiating factor at the time was that it was a genre soap opera.
Yes.
And so for people, it was like a cross-section between like monster movie kids and sci-fi kids and soap opera fans.
And but moms could watch it too.
That was sort of the breaking point.
Because wasn't it sort of like, initially it was just kind of a slightly spooky regular soap opera, and then they started like adding in more, like the fantasy stuff worked for them. Like
Barnabas comes in later.
Right? Yeah,
and
no,
he was
not
like a breakout character.
Right. And then Barnabas, if I'm remembering correctly, quickly becomes the central.
Right.
And then
they were like, oh, this guy's right.
Family Matters was supposed to be at a family, and then the next door neighbor took over.
And then it ended up being the Barnabas show. And rightfully so. Right.
But it sort of started out as just sort of like, this is like a gothic family soap
the
opera
scary
with the Collins.
Soap opera.
Right. And then it becomes like werewolves and vampires and skeletons.
And there's a lot of skeletons.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. A lot of soap opera jump scares, nothing like them.
give me just a taste.
I haven't seen the show in years.
But it's like someone opens a door and a skeleton on a wire like falls out. Is that what we're talking about?
Well, it's just like a jump scare right after a love scene in a way that's very jarring, where you're, you know, like Barnabas and like whoever the whatever fuck of the week is, like they're having this intimate conversation, and then it's like dun! and then it cuts to commercial. And you come back, and sometimes the jump scare isn't even addressed. They just have to be like, well, we got to punctuate this scene somehow.
Right.
Jump scares are all skeletons.
I'm sorry.
Skeletons.
No, you're right.
Jump scares are a thing that's like, you know, about like precision filmmaking craft. Even when they're sort of cheap and exploitive, it's all about like timing and composition.
Not on Dark Shadows, baby.
Right, because soap operas, it's like, okay, we have to shoot 8 pages of dialogue in a one-er.
Right.
That's a 5 shot. And we're doing 2 takes.
Right.
Right.
You know, that's the thing that soap opera actors always talk about is like, you got no time to work on it. You can't be precious about it.
You can't. There's like barely any time to memorize anything, much less. Oh, I love soap operas so much.
Do you still watch soap operas?
Do you have any in the rotation?
I don't. No, my mom was, we would watch the old soap operas, but she would also watch General Hospital, Port Charles, or as she said it, Port Charles. What was the other? Days of Our Lives.
Right.
So it was 3 every single night. Yeah.
Because I had a friend who was a huge like Passions fan back when Passions was being weird.
Passions was kind of the Dark Shadows of the 2000s. Yes,
like another, and where it started out normal and then like they did some shit.
That was a supernatural one. Yes.
Right,
yeah.
right.
We didn't fuck with Passions or All My Children for some reason.
I think it's a kind of a dead art form now. Like there's only 4 left.
And they've mostly migrated to like Hulu and online platforms now, right? Because the networks had like canceled them, and there was like a big campaign to be like, we're saving it!
They're like, we're waiting until the last fan dies!
Yes. The only 4 left are Young and the Restless, Bold and the Beautiful, General Hospital, Days of Our Lives. Those are the only surviving soap operas.
One of those is on Hulu now. Am I wrong?
Okay.
Whatever. So you go see this with your mom and your grandmother?
Not my grandmother.
Oh, sorry.
2 of my aunts.
Your mom and your aunts.
Yes.
And does everyone walk out? Is it the mood anger? Is it sort of disillusionment? Is it disappointment? Or is there like actual like vicious sort of like, they got it wrong?
I was upset when we left.
Uh-huh.
My mom was just as horny as when she arrived. Didn't really seem to notice anything was bad.
She was into it.
She was
just like walking out with like a thumb up.
Literally handicapped by how horny she is for Johnny Depp. She cannot discern what a bad Johnny Depp movie is. Right. All her takes on Johnny Depp are bad, such as Johnny Depp Innocent. Like,
uh-huh. Yeah,
she
just take, can't. Bad take.
She yeah. can't. She can't have. She can't see him objectively.
Did she see like Pirates 5 or whatever? Like, is she? She'll still she's, like be there for the Depp movies. Like,
I don't know. I mean, she sees them all. She may not see them all in theaters anymore.
Right.
But we all did. My aunts were disappointed. I was upset, and my mom was the
same.
It
was just like Dark Shadows A plus.
She was like, "Wow, look at that! Did you see the makeup on him? He looked. Oh, she did say his face looked very sharp in this one.
It certainly does. He lost a lot of weight for the film.
Yeah,
the contours of his face in this one.
And there's also there's a lot of contouring on him too.
Yes,
this is a movie where he's doing like full expressionistic makeup on all these actors, and then it feels like digitally augmenting it beyond that. Like this is one of those movies where it feels like Tim Burton is kind of frustrated that they're not all stop motion puppets.
Right.
And he makes everyone as heightened as possible.
Well, and he has one of the characters be a porcelain person, essentially.
Oh my God. That
Bella
so
Heathcote?
No, well, that. But no, I mean Eva Green's like weird shatter.
Oh, when she shatters at the end. There. And I also remember this movie, the screenplay.
Bella Heathcote just is a porcelain person.
Right.
But the screenplay was written by someone who I was like in college when this movie came out, and it was written by an Emerson alum. And I remember telling my mom, like, this is maybe I could do this someday. And then it was the worst
was
movie.
Was it the Abraham Lincoln Seth Grimm vampire hunter?
Yeah. Mr.
Pride,
Prejudice,
and
Zombies.
Right.
He's the, oh God, I mean.
This was the moment where Hollywood was like really hot on him. Because there had been this big bidding war for Abraham Lincoln, which Tim Burton produced.
No one saw it.
No one liked it.
I didn't see it.
But like people were going crazy when they were trying to option it. And then like,
I think it was one of those things where they were like, just look at that title. Like, that's all you need. He's a, like, they were so enamored of the concept.
Mm-hmm. There was also, it was one of those movies where Deadline was posting stories for months about like, the race to cast Abraham Lincoln is down to only 10 actors now.
Right, right.
And it was like 10
like
actors.
Scarlett O'Hara.
It was. They treated it like Scarlett O'Hara.
Smith's Abraham Lincoln.
And it was the same time that Zack Snyder was trying to cast Man of Steel, and there was a big thing where they were reaching from the same pool, and they were like, what's his name? Matthew Good has pulled himself out of contention for Abraham Lincoln because he thinks he can get Superman. Like, they were like all jockeying between those two movies. Warner Brothers sets up a big overall deal with him and Jeffrey Katzenberg's son called Katzen Smith.
Oh.
And Entertainment Weekly did this like two-page spread about like how Katzen Smith is shaking up Hollywood with bold new ideas.
Oh, I'm sorry. Are they disrupting?
They were like, these guys are disruptors. They're Hollywood, but they're a little different. And their list of things they were doing that were outside the box were like, they want to reboot Gremlins. They want to reboot. Like, it was just them rebooting properties. And they were like, but these guys are a little twisted. And so this was, John August had tried to write this movie. Someone else had tried to write this movie.
I mean, from
John
what
August
I know.
John August has a credit.
Yeah, they bought them the rights from the like estate of Dan Curtis, who created the show. They threw it to John August. Yeah. He wrote a script. They threw that out. He got the story credit. Seth Graham Smith came in, wrote his script. That was what they did.
Right. Seth Graham Smith, by the end of this movie, you're just like, in like the back half, but also the last third of the movie, there's so much stuff that happens that just, you're just like, how are we, why?
It's a lot of setup.
What's the point?
I was like, geez, how long is this movie? And then I checked and I'm like, oh, it's almost over? Wait a second. Is anything going to happen?
Suddenly.
Like, right, yeah. Right.
So my understanding at the time, I remember reading interviews and stuff and them sort of saying like, they had sort of been greenlit without a script because they were like, Tim Burton and Johnny Depp want to make a vampire movie? Right, fine, that's money in the bank. Like, especially... This is the one right after Alice in Wonderland.
Which made like $1 billion.
Right. So they were just like, whatever the fuck these guys want to do, sure.
Right.
And so I think they had the green light. The John August script wasn't working. I think they had a couple of the writers who didn't get credit try to come up with scripts. And then like...
I mean, what's truly crazy is they released this in May. Like,
yes.
How is this not released in like October or whatever? Yeah. You know, like...
They gave it like
it's a summer movie.
Summer slot.
Yeah.
And
it's a PG-13 movie about... a horny guy
yeah.
who fucks his way through town like and is a vampire.
Right. And it's also like
that's it.
It's got that thing like the Orville where it's like, is this a comedy or not?
Right.
Or do you just really like this show?
Right.
Like there
right.
yeah.
It feels kind of like a fan film. Like it feels like those guys who like got together and self-funded like more episodes of Star Trek. Who like bought the original
yeah, yeah,
sets.
Yeah. Right, right,
yeah.
Right, right, right.
I'm forgetting what that's called. Star Wars.
It's Star Trek.
Jesus Christ. Star Trek. Not Voyages.
I think it's
New
Voyages.
Voyages,
yeah. Yeah.
It feels a little like that, except with $150 million.
Those are cute because it's like they do one episode every like 2 years because it takes so fucking long.
And then they'll get the old actors to come back.
They'll get
and
like George Takei to show up, right.
But the story I remember hearing at the time was that Graham Smith was like, I know how to fix this movie, and came in and gave him this crazy pitch and was
Captain
like,
Smith.
We go for the rafters. And they kind of let him like steer the ship. Because it didn't seem like Tim Burton had any sense of what the story he wanted to tell was. He has often said in interviews, I wouldn't know a good script if it hit me.
Right.
Like he knows what he likes. He doesn't write scripts himself.
Right.
And he admittedly grew up on like trash cinema. Like he really liked like pulpy genre, you know, like B-movie programmers. So I think they were like, this Graham Smith kid is coming in. He's real hot. He's telling us that he knows how to make this movie work, and they just handed him all the story decisions.
Yeah, but this is, the story's a disaster. The story is the worst thing about this movie.
It's nuts.
It's nuts. You can't do it like this.
Back-to-back scenes of like, Helena Bonham Carter's betrayed me, I will kill her.
Right.
Next scene, making the dad go away. Go away, dad.
Yeah, right,
and
right.
then the next, I don't even, there's like five scenes in a row that have nothing to do with each other, that have no bearing on
and
the
where
plot.
Johnny Depp's character behaves in an entirely different way scene by scene. Like
it's
in one scene he's like,
so
I'm an evil vampire. And the other one he's like, look, you know, you're not pulling your weight as a dad.
But also, like, in the next scene.
The tonal thing. Like I was very
this movie's so fucking stupid.
It's really
sorry.
It starts kind of fun.
Yeah, yeah. I was fine with it. I like the idea of like he comes back. I am a sucker for like Yeah, oh, lady doctor, I'm from a long time ago. I don't know that shit.
What?
Any culture clash comedy, any fish out of water, especially when they're that heightened.
Boy?
Right. I do like, the
sections
of the movie.
Even though it's so hacky in this movie, where like, I still am like, yeah, sure.
You're like, fine. It's like Elf with vampires.
Like, Michelle Pfeiffer's just sort of there, like, sweeping around.
Oh, she is funning it. Yeah, in this one.
It was like, we were still so desperate for Michelle. Yes.
It's right.
She went like.
Yeah, it's a little bit. Like, oh, there's no point in putting this. Like, why did I know why they chose the 70s? But they should have just chosen.
Yeah,
now.
Maybe they should just. I guess that the 70s is just like homage to the show, right?
Right,
like,
but making it a period piece on top of a period piece was a stupid idea.
It is weird that he's like, I've woken up in the 70s rather than the present. It is, yeah, it doesn't make sense.
Right, well,
none of it makes sense.
Especially because it's like a reverse Austin Powers kind of thing.
Right.
You know, but the other part of it is that, like, he's so confused by all their, like, modern ways, but the ways that he perceives as modern are antiquated to us.
Right.
It's confusing. Yeah.
Because he's kind of a dirty dog.
He's a dirty
dog. You know?
And he's off.
Because it's like the 70s.
He's a freak.
He's a bit of a freak.
He's definitely a freak. There, I didn't like the throwaway Chloe Grace Moretz. This was like the most Seth Graham Smith, like, fucking edgelord line of all time. Where she's like, yeah, I'm a werewolf. Let's try not to make a big deal about it. Right. I was like, I'm going to throw myself out of this mega bus. I forgot about that line.
See that? Okay, so this is my, like, defense that will not hold up in court of this.
Has Chloe Grace Moretz like ever met a teenager in her fucking life?
Chloe Grace Moretz is an android planted by the government. Right. I've had it with her.
Right, where they were like, we need one of these young adult stars. Like, where do we get one of those?
Dr. Hobby built her.
No.
Dr. Hobby built her, and they only said 7 of the 10 keywords before
she was taken away for the
flesh carnival. What's it called?
Flesh fair.
Flesh fair.
I want Chloe Grace Moretz to be caught stealing something at a department store, so she goes away for a couple of years. Like, that's I want her to be Winona.
Get in some trouble.
Yeah. Yeah.
The thing, this is my defense. I will not be able to throw much spear behind.
Mm-hmm.
I do kind of like how much this movie just goes insane in the last 15 minutes. I do.
Oh yeah.
It's just like kitchen sink. Like
everything
excess, like just fucking like, why not? Why not just make it fucking
my
everything?
Problem is
blow
the
up the
pacing.
Cameras.
It's not like
why
this movie
not?
Has any integrity. Like, why not have everyone be?
All right, let me sum up the movie though. It's like 10-minute prologue where you're like, what the fuck is this gonna have to do
played
with anything?
Very straight.
Very, you know,
like gothic, torturous, like Sleepy Hollow esque, like.
All narration.
This great tragic love story.
Kind of reminded me of the beginning of I, Frankenstein, a movie I really love.
Never seen I,
really?
Frankenstein, written by another edgelord.
Yes.
The biggest edgelord of them all.
The edgiest lord.
Which edgelord wrote that? Which edgelord wrote that movie?
Landis.
Yeah.
Right?
No,
that wasn't Landis.
Oh, well, there's so many fucking Frankensteins. I don't know.
I, Frankenstein is written by a different edgelord.
Different? The third edgelord?
I, Frankenstein is...
Unite the lords?
I, Frankenstein is the Aaron Eckhart one.
Yeah, it's right. With Stuart Beattie.
And he, like, directed it. It was his lifelong dream, and he clearly sets it up to be a franchise.
Right, and everyone was like, no, thank
only
you.
I saw it.
Frankenstein fucks. It's also one of those things where
it's like hot Frankenstein.
Right.
Frankenstein's
Landis a
catchwork wrote the
name.
One with like
it's the
where
origin
like Daniel Radcliffe is Igor.
Correct.
Right.
I think the monster is barely in that one.
Okay.
I, Frankenstein, my favorite thing about it is they still like want him to have the stitches because that's part of Frankenstein, but they want to be like really fucking hot.
Sure. In I, Frankenstein, he plays Adam Frankenstein. And it's just like, it's the crazy thing about I, Frankenstein is that it's not really about Adam Frankenstein at all. It's about the war between demons and gargoyles.
Right. He's sort of like the underworld. Like,
was it shot in like Bulgaria?
100%.
It was shot in somewhere in Eastern Europe. And it's shot
got
in
a 4% on Rotten Tomatoes. Like, I don't take Rotten Tomatoes that seriously. But
it's really
Jesus.
It's cool to see Adam Frankenstein wake up in the modern day, and he goes to a rave, and he's like, "What is this?" And then he's like, then he finds his gargoyle friends. He's like, "Oh, thank God!"
Because oh the God. Gargoyle, Jai Courtney plays the leader of the gargoyle army.
He sure does.
Wow.
Oh my God!
Oh, it's so sad when he dies. Spoiler alert!
Is it?
Wow. Hey,
the world premiere was in Buenos Aires.
You were asking where it was shot. It was shot inside a tax loophole. Right. It was like a tax loophole
right,
open
a new
up
dimension
a hole.
Opens. Right.
The thing I was going to say about it is obviously the logic of Frankenstein is like, oh, he's got the stitches because he was stitched together from different bodies.
Yeah.
But they don't want him to be in any way sexually unappealing. So in the movie, he looks scarring. Like he was stitched together from seven different Aaron Eckharts because he's still totally symmetrical. Sure.
Yes.
That'd be good, though, if it was like, yeah, this is Aaron Brockovich Eckhart, right. And, you know, like, this one is No Reservations Eckhart. Like,
thank
all the Eckharts are together.
Yeah,
right,
they're
right,
all,
right.
They're all, the boys are all there.
Yeah.
Imagine, oh, he's very hot in that movie.
Imagine,
he's
like,
he's a cutie.
Yeah. Imagine being like Aaron Eckhart, having your run in the 2000s, you go a little cold, then, like, Thank You for Smoking sort of revives you, then you play, like, fucking Two-Face in the Dark Knight, you're like, geez, I'm back, baby. Where do I cash in my chips? I, Frankenstein. Like, all in I, Frankenstein.
I would argue I, Frankenstein is his little indie Frankenstein that he was wanting to make
right,
for a long
right.
time.
It was
he's
a passion
nurse
project.
In that
a little
one.
Under, yeah, his passion project, Frankenstein.
I mean, Sully's got to get him some more. Come on. He's so get him some Snicker
Sully.
Bars.
Have you seen Sully?
I haven't seen
fucking
Sully.
Rules.
Jimmy
greatest
Sully
movie
rolls.
Ever.
I know. I mean, I feel like I...
You're in for Sully.
I mean, my whole family saw Sully, and I didn't see Sully. I mean, you sort of one must. They're all from Sully Land, as we call it, Sullyville.
It's really it's called Sullyville now.
They renamed it Sullyville, but because of the high population of Sullys and appreciation for Sully. Uh-huh. So there was at one point in high school where my best friend and my bully were named Sully.
Truly,
two different boys.
Oh, wow.
Shit.
Yeah.
Sully's in Mensa. I know you're in Mensa.
You're a member of Mensa?
This has been a thing. I guess you're less on Twitter these days.
I'm less on Twitter these days.
I'm way less on Twitter. I got kicked off.
Again, that's happened a couple times for you, right? What was it this time?
This time, well, once I infuriated Mensa, every time that happens after that is just they'll report anything I say, and then sometimes it'll work. Right. But the tweet I got kicked off for is I threatened, quote unquote, the Zamboni twins, which are cartoons that
I
make.
Saw this. Yes.
So
you threatened two fictional creations of your own, and they flagged it as threats
yeah, that
of
are
violence.
Zambonis, right. And they're like, she's got to get off.
Yeah, I mean, you should have just said some anti-Semitic things, and then you never would have gotten banned ever.
Nope. Nope, they'll verify you
just
for that.
Just post swastikas. They're going to change the blue check mark into a swastika. That's how you're going to know people are verified on Twitter.
Hey, Ben.
What's up, David?
I want to tell you about Robinhood.
Okay, fine.
All right, here we go. Robinhood is an investing app that lets you buy and sell stocks, ETFs, options, and cryptos, all commission-free. While other brokerages charge up to $10 for every trade, Robinhood doesn't charge any commission fees, so you can trade stocks and keep all of your profits. Plus, there's no account minimum deposit needed to get started, so you can start investing at any level. The simple, intuitive design of Robinhood makes investing easy for newcomers and experts alike. You can view easy-to-understand charts and market data and place a trade in just four taps on your smartphone, and you can even view stock collections such as 100 most popular. With Robinhood, you can learn how to invest in the market as you build your portfolio, discover new stocks, track your favorite companies, and get custom notifications for price movements so you never miss the right moment to invest. Okay, so Robinhood is giving listeners a blank check, a free stock like Apple, Ford, or Sprint to help you build your portfolio. Sign up at check.robinhood.com.
What is that again?
Check.robinhood.com.
Okay, thanks.
Bye. Do you know that Seth Graham Smith is writing a Beetlejuice sequel?
That's what I was saying. That was part of the deal. He's going to reboot all these Warner Brothers things. The one good movie he gets a credit on is Lego Batman. They sort of let him take over because no one knew what the fucking movie was. Johnny Depp just wanted to do his thing. And this movie was weirdly very expensive, follow-up to the biggest movie these two guys had made. And then one of those films where, like, it was coming out in May and there still wasn't a trailer in February.
Right, right.
It was
right,
one of those movies where it's like, they're clearly hiding something because there are no posters, no trailers, no one's talked about it. And then, like, a trailer went up in March. Everyone was like, it's a comedy? Because the trailer was solely fish out of water gags. Right. The trailer's like him fighting the TV.
It's the 70s stuff, yeah.
The trailer's him looking at the lava lamp. Like, it was just that. And then this thing, I spent a weird amount of time on the Orville Wikipedia page the other day. I've never seen an episode of the Orville.
The fucking Seth MacFarlane Star Trek show that, where they can't say, like, Star Trek.
Correct.
Like, but it obviously is Star Trek, right.
But the show's become successful enough that it's like, people got a big fan base, it's got good ratings, it's got all of this.
I had a long-term crush on Seth MacFarlane.
That's interesting.
That's embarrassing.
Is he the Deadpool?
That's embarrassing. Yes, he saw Deadpool 2 so many times. Then I had to break up with him.
You know, like Deadpool because of how many good cutaway gags there are? Wait a second.
Anyways, the Orville.
The thing I was fascinated by.
You don't pivot back to this.
No. Because I'm very fascinated by the Orville as a phenomenon because everyone was like, oh, wow, Seth MacFarlane's still on this kick of trying to make himself an on-camera leading man.
Right.
So they're going to do some dumb parody version of Star Trek at the same time that real Star Trek is coming
back.
No,
the Orville is sincere.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah. I mean, with, like, jokes. So they, tell jokes.
The thing I was looking, because when people were reviewing the show when it premiered, they were like, the first four episodes are weird because they oscillate between being totally straight and episodes that are more broadly comedic.
Right.
But it's not just even a scene-by-scene thing. It's like every other episode is like this.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, the show's gotten popular. People seem to like it now. Some people.
Sure.
They must have settled on a tone. And the Wikipedia seems to imply that literally every other episode they oscillate between, like, this one's a goof.
I think Fox,
this one is super
was sort of like,
earnest.
It'll be funny, right? And Seth was like, can some of them be funny and some of them be like Star Trek episodes?
And that's literally what they've like settled on. Some of them are like dead serious, like sociopolitical like statements about like the world we live in today.
Right.
And this movie feels kind of like that on a scene by scene basis, except without any sociopolitical commentary. But it's half like total face value, like we're trying to make gothic like romance.
Right.
And half like weirdly broad fish out of water comedy.
Well, and it also just feels them trying to summarize a soap opera that ran for like 5,000 episodes.
Years.
Right.
I saw it with my friend, past and future guest, Sam Rogal, and he said that feels like a movie adapted from a TV show with 2,000 episodes. Because it feels like they tried to put all 2,000 episodes of plot into one 2-hour.
Okay, listen up. Okay, so 17th century or whatever, or 18th century, moves to England, moves to Maine, whole family, falls in love with a maid, rejects the maid, falls in love with the other lady, maid kills him, turns him into a vampire. Like, they have to get that done fast.
Right.
And it's like, this took 6 years.
Right, yes. Yeah.
There was...
And then he's dead and we cut to the 70s.
The whole beginning is funny and very, like, I don't know, very like, oh yeah, this is a Tim Burton-y thing. Where the whole way they describe the Collins family is like... And we were so awesome, and we moved to Maine, and no one was there. So we just started a cannery, and we're kind of an amazing, nice, rich family, and everyone likes us. I was like, you guys, there wasn't no one there. There were people there.
In Maine?
Also, they like continually brag about like, we built this town. It's like, yeah, no wonder people don't like you. You're like the evil rich people in this scary mansion.
In a fucking castle.
The town is named after you.
Barnabas comes back, and then they're like, open the cannery again. And then how is that? I don't know. The whole thing where they introduce these fucking like Michelle Pfeiffer's colonialist family, and then they're like, here are our heroes.
Right. That's they're the I guess, but
who are
the movie doesn't
the
really have
of every
a hero.
Tim Burton movie.
Right.
Like, he hates the sort of families who run the towns usually.
Right.
Until he had enough money to become the family to run.
Now
the
he
town.
Lives on
right.
the hill.
I mean, I've said this before. I'll say it again. I think the thing that's kind of depressing that sort of doomed Tim Burton is I get the sense that he got happy and he doesn't really have anything like any chip on his shoulder anymore.
Right. So he's just gonna,
like to, on one hand, I appreciate that he still doesn't act like he is the underdog. You know,
I mean, that would be infuriating.
Right.
Nuts. Right.
But on the other hand, now when he loses his underdog identity, it's like, what perspective does he have on the world now?
So, and then we have to rewind and be like, did he ever have any perspective? Was his perspective the very... Ooh, Griffin's going to...
That's the question.
You're pushing his buttons.
You're pushing buttons.
But the whole boy from Burbank who think the suburb's so lame. When my parents love me so much, I'm bored.
Which we have talked about even on other miniseries, how that was like at the time felt very radical about like everything around me is nice and I fucking hate it.
Right.
Exactly, yeah.
And it spoke to like a level of like Gen X like discomfort with like
the
world.
Yeah, he's like a mascot.
And it's also why his movies became so broadly popular is because any kid can relate to that, especially when it's put in such aesthetically cartoony terms, especially when his movies are so funny. It's like every kid understands any sort of like underdog outsider narrative because all kids feel weird.
And then he made this, the movie that all kids love.
Right.
Movie for kids.
Well, and this is the weirdest thing about
what
the movie.
Movie for?
Nobody. Your mom, I guess. Yeah,
my mom. I had to set my mom aflame.
This movie is for like Johnny Depp fans and Dark Shadows fans, like whatever that Venn diagram is.
But
like
Johnny
those 18
Depp fans
people.
Were falling off like flies at this moment. Right, right. And then also I feel like your mom is an exception because I feel like most Dark
Thank
Shadows
you so
fans
much.
Were your, – hey, look, your mom is – an exceptional woman.
Thank you.
But
yeah, I want to go on the record. Your mom seems great. I don't want to diss
big fan.
Your mom.
Yeah. I mean, when this episode comes out, all the stuff that'll come out about my mom, we won't be able to stand
shit,
by her
right,
anymore.
We're gonna have to fucking
her relationship with Amber.
By the time this comes out, my mom will have really jumped the shark.
She'll be canceled.
Really
yeah.
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 We're gonna have to cancel your mom.
We're gonna milkshake duck your mom.
That's gonna be my whole narrative. Is I have to cancel my own mom.
You're 20 days right.
That feels like it would be a plot line on. Like if someone was doing a show like The OC today, it would be like, right. I don't know what to do. I just realized my mom is problematic.
My mom's canceled. Yeah. Oh my God.
I have to drag her on Twitter. No, the thing I was going to say is I was surprised to hear that your mom was like, yeah, totally on board with it. Because I feel like most big fans of this show found it like totally like,
well, that's why my aunties didn't like it.
Okay, they hated it.
Yeah, my aunties were frustrated and disappointed.
It's disrespectful. Right. They got everything wrong.
They were frustrated about because they loved Victoria. And Victoria's so like, where is she? And it's like, she disappears.
She's all over like the first 20 minutes and then they're done with her. Because like, right, we cut to the present and she's like, I'm going to Colin's house or whatever.
Right.
Right.
And you're like, oh, I guess this is like the protagonist.
And then later I'm like, if Seth Graham Smith doesn't know what to do with a character, does he just make them imprisoned as a child? Like, is that his solution? He's like, because the only context we have for that like insane flashback is
which comes in like an hour and 20 minutes in, like she
long
drops
after
out
we've
late.
Given up on Victoria being a character with impact in this story.
Sure.
She's in her bed and she's a kid and she's like talking to ghosts, much like David, was that his name? What's it, the kid who's the little kid?
Yeah,
David.
Colin
that's
McGrath.
My name, but it's also Colin
McGrath. Colin McGrath.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Sorry,
David Collins.
So she also can speak to ghosts, and so they put her in an ambulance,
she's in an insane asylum or whatever.
Until 2 days before she meets Barnabas the vampire. Yeah,
but she's not twisted.
No, she's kind of unlike the other girls.
Yeah, yeah, right, right.
She's not dark.
Gets it.
Oh, also that scene with her and Michelle Pfeiffer, that Michelle Pfeiffer is like, three questions. Do you think women should have equal rights?
Right.
If no, you're hired.
And she's like, of course not.
Of
that
course
throw everything out of balance.
Do you like the president? And she's Victoria is apolitical. Later, because I'm like, maybe she doesn't know who the president is. Right. She's been locked up for her whole life.
The president at the time is Nixon, Richard M.
Yes.
Which is never really brought back up.
No. I think it's just like dumb gag.
It feels like a slam dunk joke anytime you make a movie in the Nixon era where people can like show him on TV and it's like innately funny,
and
right?
We know how that is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I don't think Burton has a take though. That's the problem. He's
just
sort of like,
no take.
He's just like, I guess this is what the show is like and like it's going to be wacky. But like the first bit is her. She shows up.
Right.
She gets hired. She meets everybody.
She's the protagonist, or at very least seems to be the audience surrogate character.
Right. She meets Michelle,
she's
who's like, this old bag of bones, or I don't know, this old pile of rocks.
Yeah.
She meets Johnny Lee Miller. She meets the kids.
Yes.
She meets Helena Bonham Carter.
Yeah. Johnny Lee Miller doing backstrokes in the River of Ham.
Yeah.
Oh,
kind of a fun performance, but he's going fucking
like
galactic
four
inside.
Scenes.
Four scenes.
Like, you know.
Yes.
And then
but he's doing a lot
of
face.
The movie.
Yeah, he's
right.
Evicted.
Right. This is
he's
the
canceled.
Thing.
The movie
then
canceled.
She sees her own ancestor as a ghost.
Right.
Seems pretty nonplussed by it. Just sort of like, okay. And the ghost is like, he's coming. Depp comes in, and then it's like, right, they have to throw out the movie for Depp to fucking do his shit for an hour.
Right, and he does
right?
a
also,
lot of shit.
What's the name of the woman who plays Victoria?
Bella Heathcote.
Okay, she is like 25 years younger than Johnny Depp.
At the very least.
I'm pretty sure it's exactly 25 years.
She might not
years.
Have been legal drinking age when this movie was shot. She's a very young woman.
They kiss.
She's 31 now.
She's 31? Yeah. Okay, so she was 20.
She's like my age.
Three?
Basically.
They kiss, and then they French. And then this is what I don't need to see.
He is 24 years older than her. No, I'm sorry. He's 14 years older than her.
No, he's not.
That's not
Wait,
true.
31,
no.
41. He's 24 years
he's
older.
20,
older.
He's old.
I'm bad
he's
at
an
mathematics.
Old motherfucker. Okay. Johnny Depp, seeing the climactic scene of this movie being Johnny Depp hitting a woman in the face repeatedly.
And saying,
boy,
like,
oh,
I'm
boy,
gonna
does
send
that
you
not
to
age
hell
well.
Or whatever.
Yeah.
Yes.
Boy, oh boy, does that not age well.
Right.
Like even 4 years after that?
Yeah, especially the fact that he also keeps on buying wine during that fight.
Yeah.
Like, he's just asking him to charge more wine to his credit card.
I mean, Johnny Depp as a, you know, unrepentant alcoholic.
Yes.
It just doesn't play.
No, no, it doesn't. Especially as a lecherous, abusive alcoholic.
Okay, but this is, yes. And again, I know that Barnabas is supposed to be like an anti-hero, right? Like, he's like.
No, he's not like the great, I mean, and again, the show's inconsistent enough that sometimes he is.
And it was a soap
guy.
Opera anyway, so you kind of just got to throw every plot at the wall. Yeah. I get that, but like.
General, though.
Right. He comes in. Mm-hmm. He's a vampire. Bad. He drinks
and we
blood.
We love that. We love that.
Right. It is cool, though.
We love that.
Because he's got superpowers.
Hey, but, I've never seen a soap opera like this.
Yeah.
Right. But he's vampire, drinks blood.
Uh-huh.
But good businessman. But mostly just because he can hypnotize people.
Sure.
I'm trying to, like, get at Barnabas here. he's in love with Victoria / whoever looks like Bella Heathcote in that, like,
right.
You
he's
know,
in love
decade.
With that bone structure.
He's in, right. He's in love with that thing.
In that, with that skeleton.
Right. But also, he's kind of horny for Eva Green and then maybe just anyone else who walks through the house, right?
Right. Because Helena Bonham Carter sort of initiates that.
Right.
That's sort of more her. Yeah.
That's when Ben had to stop the movie for a second, I think.
Yeah,
Ben,
that was that BJ moment. I had to take a break.
What was I forget where I chose to take a 2-hour nap in the middle of rewatching this movie, but there, yeah. What the that I don't.
Not
know.
That I need justification, but it's just so out of nowhere.
He does fuck it's everyone in the world he's not related to.
Yes,
right.
I'm pretty sure.
And then also though, he's just sort of like kind of a nice dad who's giving like family advice. It's all over the map, and I don't know what to grab onto with him.
No,
I don't get him.
No, Ben texted me and said I had to take a nap in the middle of this movie because it was stressing me out.
Right. That's so funny. Yeah,
and I had not started my rewatch yet. I had not seen this film in 6 years since when it was released in theaters. And I said, what made you tap out? And he said, guess. And I responded within a millisecond, the blowjob.
Yep.
I knew.
You remembered the blowjob?
I remember it so vividly because I will say the one thing that I find, and I don't say this in a positive way, but just in terms of talking about this movie in the auteurist
remembers the blowjob
perspective,
Jesus,
the Tim Burton deep dive we're doing right now, this movie is bizarre because it's the one Tim Burton movie that's hypersexual.
Right.
And his
movies
are usually fetishy, but they aren't physical. Like, people are very chaste in them.
Right.
And he always seemed like one of those, like, weird childlike directors who, like, doesn't want to deal with sex at all.
But Barnabas has to be, like, he's sexy.
This movie's like Austin Powers. Sexy. Like, he's constantly talking about sex. There's so much implied sex. There are a lot of, like, really bawdy jokes.
Right.
The blowjob thing is very fucking weird. And then she's thrown in the bottom of a river.
He does throw his then wife to the bottom of a river.
Yeah, and then wife, but you know, Sue, or I think they never married. But this is the last Bonham Carter in the first Eva Green movie.
Right. This is sort of the handoff.
Is he with Eva Green?
Unclear. They were seen hanging.
She's been in obviously all his movies.
I didn't enjoy her in this movie very much. But I also didn't really enjoy anyone in this movie.
Yeah,
so
I love Eva Green. She's sort of an insanely like stunning person. So it makes sense. Casting her as a witch is the laziest casting decision anyone can make. It's been done like 3 times.
Correct.
Like, you know, and what I couldn't handle is her accent where she's like half American and then half just Eva Green regular.
It's weird. The other thing that's weird with her is like watching her in this movie with blonde hair. You're like, that's not right. She looks weird as a blonde. Do you know that she is a blonde and just dyes her hair black all the time?
Because of her classic her witch type.
Yes. Because she is a witch.
Her goth casting?
But she's one of those people where it's like, oh yeah, she looks like a Tim Burton drawing. She has that sort of like heightened energy. She would make sense in Tim Burton movies. Mm-hmm. She's done 2 of them now, the third one, which is about to be released.
Yeah.
And they don't really work. Like, the performance doesn't really work. I don't think she's bad?
She's better in Peregrine.
Right, but she also has very little to do in that movie.
She does.
This movie, at least, she's kind of fun.
She's got some things.
The accents all
I
over
like
place.
I do, you know, the cracking thing is kind of.
I like that visual.
He's like the whole, and also Barnabas telling you, you have no heart. I'm like, you have fucked everyone at this house.
Right. Yes.
Truly.
But there's
they
also.
They both suck. They're both. Let them both fuck off to hell. I don't care.
There's also this weird note.
Such bad writing.
It feels like a studio note where they're like, look, we don't want Barnabas to look like a predator. So can we make it that all the women want to fuck him? Because for how much sex he has in this movie, there's a lot of women like aggressively being like, fuck me now.
And he looks horrible. Right. I mean, it is that thing where like Depp is just no longer very charismatic.
Yeah.
He looks like a fucking weirdo.
It's interesting to me that this is a character he really wanted to play because that didn't read to me in the performance at all.
it reads like he's just doing his shit.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, hello.
That's so interesting. Yeah, I assumed he was cashing a check.
I would tie the cape around my house and run around the living room pretending to be Barnabas. Like, he was like, this movie is entirely him pushing this rock up a hill.
That's so weird.
To no
Why didn't
resistance?
He try harder? Yeah. That's so weird. I don't know. Yeah. The whole Eva Green, I mean, the Eva Green character, the way the character's written, because Angelique's another character from the show.
Sure. Mm-hmm. And she's like, you know, one of the villains, right? Like
she's a schemer. It's not like, right. It's like, again, it's like over years. But in this movie, she is like, poor and wasn't allowed to look at him when she was a child.
Right.
And then he kind of like.
Forgot about that. Also a weird moment.
Weird. Like, why was that there?
Right.
And then he kind of like gives her the fuckboy manifesto when they're older. And he's like, oh, I cannot tell you I love you. It would be a lie or whatever. And then she's like, okay, I'm going to punish you for the rest of your.
Curse you as a vampire.
I'm going to force everyone you love to commit suicide.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And also the ending of this movie is so dumb.
Can we talk about the cliff?
This cliff.
Let's talk about
quite a cliff.
People love this cliff.
What's with the logic of the cliff?
They're addicted to the cliff.
They're addicted to the cliff. They're so like I just feel like I've never seen a movie deal with cliffs in new ways.
I
like,
mean, it is Maine. I guess it's a cliffy place.
Yeah. When in other stories have you ever heard of a cliff turning people into something?
It's true. Yeah. Falling off the cliff turns you into a vampire.
A haunted cliff isn't really like a popular trope.
Well, also again, the movie's
is the
just
cliff
kinda,
haunted.
I don't know.
It's certainly got some bad juju.
Or is the spell like that she's whipping up is like you become a vampire,
you
but
never
you
see
must
her do a
jump
spell.
Off the cliff.
The only spell she casts is capitalism. You know what I'm talking about?
Swish.
That's the thing. Like, this movie is like the tagline for this movie in the apathetic marketing campaign that started 6 weeks before it was released in 3,000 theaters.
No.
The tagline was, every family has its demons.
Right.
And I feel like all the like taglines in the trailers were things like, strange is relative.
That's the subtagline.
Like, they were trying to
They're just trying to be like, this is the Addams Family.
And
like,
then the character posters are so lazy where they're just like, each one's one color and then desaturated their faces.
Gully McGrath's famed character poster.
I joke about this all the time.
Hyped up for Gully McGrath.
I joke about this all the time. It's a running joke on the podcast.
Gully Nation was freaking over that poster.
Can you imagine?
Gully. What's he up to these days, Gully?
He was in Lincoln. 2012 was big for him.
2012 is his, it seems like that's his year.
Yeah, he was in Lincoln.
Oh, he's got a jaunty hat here.
It's like I always say, give me the Gully. I love Gully.
Your childhood, you were demonized by Sullys, but saved by Gullies, right? Because you said your bully was named Sully, but Gully was your best friend.
That's he's basically be my memoir, done Sullys and Gullies.
Then. Really? He's Australian, right?
Yep. Here's Johnny Lee Miller's character poster. I mean, you know, that's got to be worth $5, right?
Like, all these posters feel like an intern made them in 5 seconds on Photoshop, and the angles they're trying to hit is like...
Did you talk to Jackie about this one?
You know what I did talk about with him?
Because he worked with Jackie Earle Haley.
Oh, no way.
Great actor, great
he's
man.
He's one of the few performances I really enjoy.
I think he's really
fun.
He's just dialed in. He's perfect for that role. Yeah. He's funny.
He's got an axe, sure. Yeah.
I think the thing that Jackie Earle Haley is great at is identifying what the tone of the movie is.
Right, mm-hmm. right,
because
right.
he's capable of being very small. He's capable of being very big and working in different genres. But like even movies I hate, like the RoboCop remake, mm-hmm. he's the one guy who's at like the exact right pitch. And he's doing a pretty, like, not cartoonish thing in that movie.
Right.
He did weirdly talk about that movie a lot because he couldn't stop raving about how good his wig was in that movie.
Oh, it is a nice wig.
It's a good wig.
He was talking
and
about...
And I'm sure he wears a lot of wigs.
Yes.
It's probably big coming from him.
He's like an ideally bald man where you can place any sort of mannequin hairstyle on him. Mm-hmm. And he was, I will not name names, but he was dragging actors who wear toupees.
Sure.
Like, not character wigs, but come in with their own toupee. And they're like, this is my own hair. And it's like, the movie looks shitty now. Let the the hair and makeup department.
The hair
department.
People can give you a great wig, right?
Right.
So, I liked Johnny Depp's bangs in this movie.
Sure. I like his little sunglasses.
Oh, yes, I did like the kind of oversized, kind of that kind of hackery. Right. I kind of liked that.
If he was a hacker in this movie, you know, maybe then we've got something. Why, he woke up in the 90s, you know.
Get Barnabas a computer for crying out loud.
A bones computer.
Give a bones computer.
Yeah.
Made of bones. A haunted computer from the cliff.
That would make this movie 100 times
better.
Someone
should force Tim Burton to make a movie for like $5 million again. And get him back to basics and be like, this is called the haunted computer. Go off. Do it.
I just imagine like me walking into Hollywood, like I'm like the big script polish guy. And they're like, come on, David, what do we do with Dark Shadows? And I'm like, easy, haunted computer. And they're like, oh, my God.
And then it gets a virus on the haunted computer. And then the computer becomes real.
Oh, shit. Real?
A desktop grows legs. That's
like a sentient desktop? What do you want to say?
No, Jamie, we are recording this episode like 5 months in advance of when it comes out. So, A, this is on the record. And B, you can now just go pitch this to Tim Burton.
The script written by the time this comes out.
You can have this written in production. My takeaway walking out of this movie, even though I liked it more than the rest of you, and I can't really defend it at all, but I just, you know, whatever. I fall for his shit. I get drunk and I end up hooking up with Tim Burton again and I regret it. But there are the two things about it I was going to say. One, I walk out of this and I go, okay, but seriously, someone like sit him down, give him a limited budget, make him like focus up and tell a real story. And then I would argue he does that and no one goes to see the movie.
Well, which one?
Big Eyes.
Big Eyes.
Oh, interesting. I did not hate Big Eyes. I saw Big Eyes.
I like Big Eyes a lot. Whether or not you like it, it was him doing exactly what he needed to do in his career, which is like focus up, tell a human story, work with real actors,
script. I agree with that.
Yep.
And I did kind of hate the fact that no one fucking went to see it and that everyone kind of shrugged it off.
There's a reason no one went to see it.
No one
cares.
I'm aware.
Some of the eyes were big.
They're really big.
They are really big.
Don't be disrespectful. They're really big.
And I'll admit this. I didn't even see the movie.
Well,
and I love
it.
Big shit.
You'll see it next week. Oh, right. You'll love the eyes.
Right, right.
But the other thing I was going to say, the you know.
Did you like, polish? I'll do it next week. But Clint Eastwood should have played the art dealer. And he's just like, why are the eyes so big? That's what I wanted. Just him wandering like. The eyes are really big.
What are those eyes? Why are they so big? Get off my face.
That was teetering into Jack Nicholson.
That movie, we'll talk about it next week, but that movie, it should just be like, someone should just be like, the fuck is with you and the eyes? Like, why are they so big? And instead the movie gets too bogged down and like, oh, the guy stole her.
The movie's trying to tell you how the eyes are big, but then you're like, just someone asked the question directly.
Right, someone, like, and, you know, I get that they were popular, which is what the movie becomes about, but I wish someone would just get it out of her like, is you just like them big?
Because of the pain.
Yeah, it was because the pain.
Because of all that pain.
I just feel like, you know.
All the better to reflect the patriarchy.
We'll talk about this.
What about Frankenweenie?
Next week.
I've never seen Frankenweenie.
I love it.
I think we're gonna do Frankenweenie behind a paywall.
We'll figure it out. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
We'll hide that in some tier. It'll be $1,000 black label episode.
Right.
Just because this main series is too fucking long.
Yeah, he's an unwieldy career.
This movie. Had a very big budget and underperformed at the box office.
This movie, this movie cost $150 million.
Mm-hmm. It did like 80 domestic.
Yeah, we'll get to that.
But it's still like when you go, okay, this was a failure. The critics didn't like it. It lost money. It still made like 9 times what Big Eyes make.
Sure.
If you're Tim Burton, you kind of slink away from that and go like, I don't know. I guess I should keep making these big things.
Dumbo.
Big Ears.
Yeah, Big Ears. He makes Big Ears, and they retitled Dumbo.
Making Big Ears. Look, he can make as many movies as he wants as if he puts Colin Farrell in him. He can make Dark Shadows with Colin Farrell, and I'd watch it.
Colin.
Yep. I just feel like if he's got enough money, it's like he's done. He has enough money to live 500 lives now. So why doesn't he just make? Yeah, he's going full Barnabas.
Yeah,
but like then just make the movies you want to make. You don't gotta live 500 more years.
It seems like
dude.
The diagnosis is like maybe he just doesn't know what he wants to make. Right? Like I don't know.
Here's what bugs
the boy
me.
From Burbank.
There are a bunch of things that like when he was like in his like 90s golden boy period.
Right.
Was developing that they were like, too far out there. We're not going to make this. That right, I think right. he could make today.
He could warm him up.
And I'm always waiting for him to pull one of those like passion projects out of the vault, and it like doesn't fucking happen. He signs on to another $200 million. It's Tim Burton's twisted take on blank. And like one of them is like what the fuck is it called? There is a manga comic.
My the Psychic Girl. That's right. What you're talking about.
Which he wanted to adapt as a musical with Sparks doing all the songs.
Right.
Oh.
And that's exactly what I want to see him do.
Look kind of cool.
Yes.
Yeah, that sounds
really good.
Know, that's such an oddball project. He's clearly passionate about it. Him doing a musical, again, sounds great. Him doing fucking something with Sparks sounds great. Like, yeah. I wish he, like, pulled out, like, right. Like Sweeney Todd, which I like, is like very much.
Do you like the Sweeney?
I do like Sweeney Todd.
Sweeney.
Yes. Hello. But that was someone where he was like,
Barnabas.
This meant a lot to me.
Gonna make you a pie.
I
my Sweeney episode is gonna be wild.
Yeah. You want him to like pull out like shit that he cares about, not like big brand shit, you know, but like people he wants to work with, writers he likes. I don't know.
You're, sure.
Because he kind of can make anything now.
He can, yeah. If he feels strongly about something, Timmy. Just do it. You got the money.
It's just
Timmy, you listening?
Frustrating because Timmy. In such a franchise branded universe, he's one of the guys where like his name is the brand. Mm-hmm. So like Tim Burton's take on whatever, that's the marketing campaign. It doesn't matter if it's based off a book that everyone knows. You know?
Tim Burton's haunted computer.
Yeah, bone Tim computer.
Tim Bones.
The Bones computer.
The haunted computer.
The Bones computer.
The visionary mind of Tim Burton.
What computer?
From the visionary computer.
Oh, man, David.
Yep.
I'm kind of sad.
Why are you sad?
Well, I don't know. Just life stuff.
It happens.
Yeah.
It's okay.
But I've been using Talkspace.
Yeah. Right. Friends of the show.
This is helpful.
Their service, they can give you someone to talk to, support you through the rough patches, everyday ups and downs in life.
Yep. Because there's ups and there's downs.
Yeah. And it's sort
this
of.
This is part of life.
It's up and down. Ups. And downs, shoots right. and ladders,
yes,
peaks and valleys,
yes.
And Talkspace is like mobile therapy. It's available whenever you need it. It's affordable, and it's a way to talk to someone anytime you're maybe feeling a little down.
Because it's hard to find a therapist.
Find a therapist. They're expensive. They're the insurance can be complicated. Like sorting through everyone like that,
it's a nightmare. So I just said, you know what? I'm going to use Talkspace, and it's been great. I got connected with somebody quickly. And here's the deal with Talkspace. Like David said, you can text, you can call,
right.
you can send them a picture.
4,000 people. Yes.
You can send video messages. I've been sending like updates constantly to my therapist, almost in a way where it might be harassment.
A little too much.
Yeah. But right. I'm letting them know what is up with me.
Okay.
Uh-huh. And it's great.
It's like you making eggs.
Walking around, chasing geese.
Chasing geese?
I was doing that yesterday. I don't know. You got to sometimes like just live life.
You know, there's a lot of geese out here in Brooklyn. All right. Well, finding the right therapist doesn't have to be stressful. Talkspace matching process. It takes your unique preferences into account. It finds you someone whose style and expertise matches your needs. You can switch at any time, no extra cost. They got like 4,000 therapists to choose from. It's convenient and easy to use, and you can schedule a session whenever you like, but you can also just send messages
like you're saying. Like if I'm, vaping, I want them to know about it. Or if I'm crying, send a message.
And 1 month of therapy on Talkspace costs about the same amount as a single face-to-face session with a therapist. And you'll never have to wait a week to share what's on your mind.
All right. Well, tell them how they can also...
I'll call to action, if you will. Yes, all right.
Call to action.
Let's call to action. All right. Talkspace has more than 4,000 licensed therapists who are experienced in addressing the challenges we all face. To match with your perfect therapist for a fraction of the price of traditional therapy, go to Talkspace.com. Make sure to use the code CHECK to get $45 off your first month and show your support for this show. That's CHECK and Talkspace.com.
Or if I want to like show her my new pit.
Yeah, you've got a pit outside your apartment here.
Yeah.
It's a big pit.
It's pretty cool.
Someone's going to go in it. Who knows what?
Ben is.
Are you?
Yeah.
Okay. Is there anything left to say about fucking
I mean, we
Shadows?
Fan praise, but we got to say it because you're here. This movie does pass the Bechdel cast.
It passes the Bechdel test.
No, it does pass the test, though.
A lot of female characters.
Yeah, it does pass the Bechdel test many times.
Yeah.
Well, not many. It passes.
Yeah.
But it passes with weird phrases like, do you believe women deserve equal rights? No.
Sure.
So that's not a great pass.
No, it's a soft pass. It's a very soft pass.
It's a flawed metric.
He kills all the hippies?
I like that scene.
Yeah, it's kind of a funny scene.
Anna Murray.
Yeah, that's funny. I was like, oh, this is a comedy. And then the next scene, it's like, no, it's not.
But it's just, Depp just should be dialed in. And it's just like, regrettably, I must kill you now. And you're just like, that's all you got for this? Like, where's the fun?
I've never felt less feeling
Jack
between
Sparrow
two.
Here.
Like, Johnny Depp and Bella Heathcote, there's nothing there.
Yeah. No,
I'm like, they may have never actually met. they may have been like, she's legally too young to be around you, so we're going to just make a kissy face in front of a green screen.
Which has to work child hours.
Yeah.
Is she the one who eats in Neon Demon, who eats the other model? That's pretty cool. And then barfs up an eyeball.
Yeah, I think she's very good in that movie.
Me too. I like her in Professor Marston.
The green throw up.
Oh, yeah, that was fun. That's goofy.
That comes out of nowhere.
Yeah.
That's in your. You see, you like the final crazy 15 minutes when it's just barf and
I just
vomit.
Like when they're just like, fuck it. She's a werewolf. They're vomiting. They're on the ceilings.
What do you got, Jamie?
Well, I liked the barf, but then he just beats her up for like 10 minutes.
Right. Yeah,
and we don't want to see Johnny Depp beating a lady up.
Yeah,
we don't.
Like, throws a few.
We don't
want to
see Johnny Depp beating up a blonde woman.
No, never again.
It is, and then she shatters, which I thought was like the most Tim Burton.
She takes her heart out, offers it to him.
And then he's like, I cannot accept. And she shatters. Mm-hmm. So what? He was wrong. She had a heart the whole time. So he's wrong.
I mean, he's wrong.
Come on, Griff. Come on, weigh in.
Yes.
Did she have a heart or not?
She did. She offered it to him.
Well, is it a heart?
And then they go Twilight at the end, and then Victoria, which in the show, if I recall correctly, Victoria does eventually become a vampire as well.
Right.
But what a weird way to end the movie of like, no, she has to kill herself.
Yeah,
she
the
has
movie
to.
Ends.
One must
setting up a sequel, and then people would ask Tim Burton like, "Are you going to do a sequel?" And he's like, "No, I don't think so.
It's not meant to be a franchise. Like, right.
Darker shadows."
But I guess he was just like, soap operas have cliffhangers, so it should have a cliffhanger.
You do feel though, like
a cliff at the end.
There is a cliff.
There's a universe in which you go like, okay,
haunted vampire cliff.
It's not Dark Shadows, right? You don't have the property Dark Shadows.
So instead, you just do like he's a vampire. And he comes back to the 70s.
In 2010 or whenever, when they were trying to greenlight this movie, right?
Yeah.
If you said, oh my God, here's the pitch. Johnny Depp and Tim Burton do a movie. We're playing off the Twilight thing. Everyone thinks vampires are sexy now. Mm-hmm. It's a movie where like a 1700s vampire wakes up in modern day and he doesn't know what anything is anymore.
Right.
That would work as a broad comedy, as sort of like a pre What We Do in the Shadows, like fish out of water.
Yeah.
That's what it would be.
He's right. really
like
heightened.
Committed to
right.
it.
He's
I mean,
like
What
this,
We Do in the Shadows is right. The movie that cracked that
right.
like, did a good job.
And
right.
makes this movie even shittier because then the comedy stuff doesn't really
right.
work even less than it did when it was released.
Yeah.
Right. Yes.
Well, the problem is, as Jamie's kind of said, like he comes back and he's like a rich guy. So, like, there's not a lot of tension.
And they don't
like
have
a
any
fucking
conflict.
Rich guy. He comes back, he like, opens a secret thing,
yes.
and it's, like, a bunch of riches.
Yeah.
There's no... Yeah, he immediately makes them wealthy again.
Right.
They accept him.
Yeah.
Right, they're like, cool, right. There's like, that scene where he is revealed to be a vampire to everyone else, and they're like, but then that's it.
But then they're like, okay.
Yeah. And Chloe Grace Moretz is a werewolf.
Right.
Yeah, so don't make a big deal
Very
out
empowering.
Of it.
Very empowering.
Ugh,
I mean,
God.
You're right.
Hey, could you tell that she was cool because she listens to music all the time? Did you guys pick up on that?
Yeah. No, she's like super, super cool. And she has like strong takes about the music of the time. And we love that.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Oh, because I couldn't tell at first, but I was like, this is the 70s. Right. Okay.
That's why Chloe Grace Moretz is there to remind you what year it is.
I am realizing as we talk over this, the only dramatic conflict of the movie is... Will Johnny Depp punch this blonde woman? It truly is because everything else they resolve.
She's like, I'm going to ruin your life. Yeah.
Right. Because everything else that's introduced as a conflict gets resolved within the same scene.
I mean, there's this sort of.
The
like,
dad's a problem. We're shipping him off. The business is failing. He brainwashes
the psychiatrist
people.
Is stealing his blood.
Throw her in the
throws
her
off the fucking haunted cliff.
Right. The only long term conflict in this movie is when's he going to punch that woman?
Right. Right.
Which is bad.
It's not great.
He does a lot.
He does.
And
a
he
lot.
Does, and she's dead. Okay.
Okay, so Johnny Depp kills a lady. That's awesome. He actually kills a lot of people.
He does. He kills a lot of people.
He kills a lot of people.
Mostly off screen.
Yeah. Chloe Grace. Oh, there's also that big, like, no
they
big
have
deal.
Sex too. Eva Green, and that where they're like fighting and smashing the room.
Right, and the piano and stuff. Which is just weird to see in a Tim Burton movie. Like, it's.
It is.
It's kind of equivalent to the sex scene at the end of Munich, it's where it's like, it feels weird to show him, like, to see him shooting sex scenes. Like, that feels like that doesn't fit into his universe.
I feel like that's maybe why the sex scene is so uncanny valley and bad.
Right, right. Really
weird. Where Tim Burton's just like, I don't.
Yeah, you're all clawing at each other. I don't know.
Plays the piano with her butt.
Helena Bonham Carter and I just stare at each other really hard. I don't know.
But they were like one of those couples where like the whole time they were together, they lived in separate houses.
Right.
They had like two different small gothic cottages that were like connected by an underground tunnel.
In, like, Parliament
How is it not exhausting being a person like that? I don't know. It just sounds exhausting to having to commit to the bit quite that hard.
I'm going to tell a story now that I didn't know if there was an appropriate episode to tell, but I'll just tell it here. Yeah. So I, like, Tim Burton kid, Die Hard, he was my guy. Mm-hmm. I'm, like, 10 years old. We have to do an independent research project at school. I'm like, Timmy B, baby. I'm doing my Tim Burton thing. I'm all in on it. Right. I'm, like, 10. I'm reading, like, Burton on Burton books. Sure. You know, in, like, a limited internet access era. I'm, like, going all in on everything I can find. All of it, right?
He's hitting JSTOR.
Yes. And my dad comes home one day and goes, like, I have some big news for you. And I was like, what is it? And he was like, new tenant moving into our building, like apartment 7J, Tim Burton. And I was like, what? And he was like, got the scoop from the front desk. Whoa. He's moving in. And it was him and Lisa Marie.
So yeah, when are we talking his old?
This is 2000.
This is
a good time to be Tim Burton.
Right. This is 99-2000. It's pre-Planet of the Apes. So in my mind, he has not made a bad film ever. Right? I'm like, this guy is 10 for 10.
Lisa Marie's in Planet of the Apes.
Correct? Yep. So this is before they're going to film Planet of the Apes. He moves into the building, and I'm just like...
That's really exciting.
Like, shaking with excitement, right? Now, you talk about, like, it must be exhausting to, like, be that much yourself, right?
Yes.
At the age of 10, when Tim Burton's reputation is still really good, his quality, you know, consistency of output is really strong and high and everything, my thing was just, like, this dude's brand is fucking awesome. And Halloween is going to be lit in this building now. Like, as a 10-year-old, I was like,
he moves in and, like, spiders are carrying the fucking bags or whatever.
Because he moves in, like, a November or December, right? So I've got to wait almost a full year to get that Halloween going.
Okay.
No.
You never see him in the building, right? And it was just like, when's Halloween going to come?
He's busy
when's
with the Halloween apes.
Gonna come?
Right.
And we're doing it in our building. I live in an apartment building, and trick-or-treating in New York City is terrible. But you're like going up and down the stages.
I just would run loose in my building,
My building was full of old people who didn't like children.
Okay.
We like got to his like, because he had like a fake name on like the board in the building. But we knew which apartment was his.
Mr. Bones?
Yeah.
Spooky Spookerson.
And I was like, we're going to like ring the bell and like Lisa Marie's going to come out in Rick Baker makeup.
Right.
And like you said, there's going to be like a skeleton, like fucking a spider in the background and whatever. Like he'll have dressed up. We'll get a look into his apartment, and he literally just had the bowl with the fun size, and just a sign that said like "take one." And it wasn't even his handwriting. Like I was like, maybe the sign will have like a drawing on it or whatever. And it was the most.
Did he even answer the door, or was it just like
no? It was one of those. The bowl's there. Please take one.
Right.
Wow.
Yeah,
that's a bummer. So you never saw Timmy B.
I met him in the elevator once. Uh-huh. And it was like an out-of-body experience.
And were you like, I'm a big fan of Tim Burton?
I could barely speak, and my dad did the talking for me and was like, this is my son. He like, you know, he did a presentation. Oh, man, that's cool this far out. And I just was like, like I went to school. I told everybody, simply the best. Like I was just like on like such a high. But I met him for like 5 seconds. He was nice to me.
That's great.
I mean, it was like, you know, 4 floors of conversation before we got to his... You know, his moment to walk out.
Well, my friend in high school was his mom was Samantha. It was Samantha Morton's agent, but was also Helena Bonham Carter's agent.
Okay,
So they knew them. I don't know. They were nice.
Yeah,
that was all. That was all I heard. They were fine.
Supposed to be nice people.
Yeah, I lived in their house.
Yeah.
You would not hear that like Tim Burton was like cooking at a cauldron or whatever.
No, I think he's fairly like
Yeah, I don't know. He's 60.
He's 60. It's weird that he's 60.
He's tired.
He's tired.
Let him sleep. Will you let Tim sleep? Don't wake him up for Dark Shadows.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah, let him sleep. In
let
his,
him sleep
for a thousand years.
His cute little house.
Okay, let's do box office game on this movie. I did look it up. They literally didn't release a trailer until mid March, and the film came out mid May.
That's crazy. So
Jamie, for a $150 million movie, that's like a clear sign that you're giving up.
Box office game is. I'm gonna.
Please.
Griff's going to try and guess the movies that were top five of the box office the week this movie came out.
Oh, okay.
This is the only thing my brain stores.
Yeah,
oh,
it's
this is
really
great.
Alarming.
Yeah.
So May 11th, 2012.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I know the one that I, okay.
So number one, you probably know what number one was.
Was starting the summer, was Avengers?
Yeah. Right. And so in its second week.
Yeah.
In its second week, Avengers made $103 million.
Right. First movie ever cracked 200 in the weekend.
So that was still just... You know, that was it. Dark right. Shadows opens against us, like, you know, who cares?
Like, I'm still, like, an apologetic Burton fan. I go see Dark Shadows opening night, but that weekend I remember specifically being more excited to see Avengers a second time.
Right. Did you see Avengers,
after
Jamie?
Not
Did
liking
you care about Avengers?
The previous Marvel movie. Movies. I think Avengers is great. But I
I love Avengers, too. I like Marvel movies.
It seems like people like it. I've never seen it.
They're quite popular.
I think that one's very well written.
No, I mean, we love the Avengers.
We'll talk about the Avengers.
Yeah. Number three is a, sort of like a ensemble comedy based on an advice book.
Oh, I saw this.
What
you did?
What to expect and you're expecting?
Nope.
No, it's
not.
Who do you think it's by, Jamie?
I know the word guy.
I know what it is.
You're close. You're close.
Is it Think Like a Man?
Think Like a Man.
The first one?
That's not what
what you're thinking of? Okay.
Whoa.
Which one were you thinking of?
I was thinking of a movie that I think actually came out in 2010.
Which is?
He's Just Not That Into You.
Yes. Oh, sure. Right. Yes. Another of the anthology.
Right.
Nonfiction turned into
bad movie.
Right.
That was the start of them. And then there was The Rush where they were like.
Think Like a Man is kind of like an updated take on that where it's like, you know, relationships. We're all in them.
But that's that run where it's like you buy an advice book, you make it into
Steve Harvey's
an
advice
ensemble.
Book. Think Like a Man,
Steve
Act
Harvey's.
Like a Lady. Yes.
Yes.
The plot of these two movies, the first one, because I'm like, he's just not that into you or like what to expect when you're expecting. It's like. They take the sort of lessons from the book and they dramatize them into funny little slice of life settings with Chase Crawford or whatever.
Yeah.
This one is about everyone reading the book.
Oh, weird.
It's all the women in the relationship start reading the Steve Harvey book. Steve
and
Harvey's
then
name
they
is
roast
said
their men?
8,000
And
times.
Steve Harvey's in it as himself.
Yes, but only through talk show appearances.
Okay,
I think they never meet him.
Sure. Okay.
But it's weird
That's
because
crazy.
Yeah, they treat Think Like a Man in the movie like it's the Bible and it's the thing that like unlocks them. It's kind of like Book Club, except more about the book than the film Book Club.
Right.
Whoa.
But the other weird thing is his advice book is like, hey, listen to me. I'm Steve Harvey. I've been divorced several times.
Right.
My advice is for a marriage to work, the woman has to do everything the man wants to do and also figure out what the man wants and think like him and preemptively do those things before
think
he
like
asks.
Think like him, don't behave like him. Think like him and then
yeah, but then
do
be ladylike. Fuck Steve Harvey. Those movies are kind of fun.
I like it when Keenan does Steve Harvey, though, on
I do
SNL.
Too.
He's really funny.
Yeah. The second one is like a just the boys go to Vegas movie.
Oh, great.
It has nothing to do with like the advice sort of shit. It's the boys. Two of the people are getting married and all the boys and the
think
girls.
Think like a man, too.
T-O-O.
Yep.
The boys and the girls go to Vegas, and it's like a bachelor party, a bachelorette party. Mm-hmm. And the only way that Steve Harvey is brought into the movie is they get really hung up playing the Steve Harvey slot machine in Vegas.
Isn't Turtle? God. Turtle's in it.
Turtle's in both of them. Turtle. He is dating Gabrielle Union, because that makes sense.
Are you cool with Turtle? You down with Turtle?
I'm down with Turtle.
Yeah, he likes sneakers. Okay, number four is a big, huge, gigantic movie of the summer.
Are you joking?
No. It's like franchise starter. It's been around for like 8 weeks at this point.
Of the summer, so it's from the spring.
It's from the
truly.
Spring.
But it was a big big spring picture.
Split seasonal hairs
I'll split
with me.
Split seasonal hairs with you.
Yeah.
Okay. So
yeah, you're right. It came out in March.
Franchise starter.
Yep.
In March.
Made $400+ million.
Whoa.
Giant smash hit.
2012?
Oh, The Hunger Games?
The Hunger Games.
Hunger Games.
With Jennifer Lawrence.
A massive movie, and a star is born. I mean, that's when she becomes a superstar. And then she wins an Oscar.
Cool.
And then she turned 23.
Right.
Upsetting.
And then number five
it's crazy how fast and how big everything happened for her. Yeah. I just was like thinking about her career arc the other day and just realizing how much of a mental breakdown I would have.
Being her, like having that.
Just the rocket ship speed, and then everyone being like, she's fun, we want to get drinks with her. Right. And then being like, no, fuck her.
Right.
She seems fine, too. She seems very
well-adjusted. She seems kind of okay with her.
She's doing all right. Yeah. Number five is Nicholas Sparks-y kind of thing. I'm not actually even sure if it's Nicholas Sparks.
Is it the Miley Cyrus one?
No.
It's not the Vow.
No.
Is it the one?
It stars another teen idol, like now.
Is it the Zac Efron one?
Zac Efron.
It's Zac Efron and Taylor Schilling.
It is Sparks, yeah.
And it's not called The Best of Me, right? That's James Marsden.
No, it's not called that.
Is it called the something?
Yeah. It's the blank blank.
Fuck. Yeah. And is it describing the person?
Yeah, because the names are always so like.
Is it describing the person or is it describing the relationship?
Person, I think. I haven't seen it.
Is it like the blank man? Is it something like that?
No, it's the blank blank. Not man.
The quiet one.
Nope. Close. One is right.
Fuck. It's not quiet.
The
it's
nice
not,
one.
It's not brave.
I'm sure he's nice.
The good one.
No. Oh, my God. It's the fun one. The blank one. What kind of tone are they putting out? What kind of vibe does this guy have?
Pulled out my headphones. He was in War.
Is it the brave one?
No, that's Jodie Foster.
And right. Survived.
That's
the only one? The last one?
Nope.
The strong one?
Ben gave you a clue.
He was in War?
He survived.
He survived. The living one? What am I?
L is right.
Yeah.
The lonely one?
Nope.
Oh, that's.
We're getting so close.
The
like we're hovered around
one.
This.
The.
He survived. The lucky one.
The lucky one.
He yep. was lucky because he got to be in a Nicholas Sparks story.
Exactly.
Okay.
Oh. He's got abs.
Wow.
Up the wazoo. No look at those abs.
It. Yeah.
God.
Well, you don't see abs in that.
I mean,
you're
right. Pecs. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he probably has abs.
Go Zac Efron.
Where do you stand on Zac Efron?
I love him.
I'm a big fan.
I love him.
I'm a big fan.
He's got range.
I think he's a really good actor and a really good movie star. And I was really excited when, like, Neighbors, it was like, okay, they finally cracked him. Now he's taken seriously and everything he's made post-Neighbors
yeah.
has been a disaster. Mike and Dave and Baywatch.
Oh, right. Yeah, Baywatch. I like that he does it.
I
like that he does it. I don't know. I still really like Zac Efron.
I always wanted him to be doing like comedies.
I wanted to bring back his High School Musical haircut.
He's so fucking good in High School Musical 3.
God.
All right.
In all of them. That his number in High School Musical 2, right on the golf course.
I just like 3 because it's like cinematic. They got some real production value.
I mean, well, they got the movie budget.
Exactly.
Time.
Right. And they're one of the theaters, baby.
DCOM.
Yeah.
I like the one who plays the piano in High School Musical. The like weird.
The girl.
Who's got like glasses or whatever.
What's her? Odessa Rulin or whatever.
Sure.
Yeah.
The girl. She's awkward.
She's awkward.
But she gets kissed at some point.
Of course.
They all get kissed.
Gotta get a kiss.
Corbin Blue.
Yeah.
Corbin Blue is, I heard, in Beetlejuice the Musical right now.
Is he playing Beetlejuice?
Very bad.
Alex Reitman is playing Beetlejuice. I know. Alex Brightman. He originated the role of Dewey Finn in the School of Rock musical. He's playing the Juice. What was the thing I was going to say about High School Musical?
I'm looking up Corbin Blue on the Internet Broadway database.
Corbin Blue Beetlejuice? This is something someone told me yesterday.
Looking it up.
Oh, no. Okay, yeah.
No,
he's in the DC
he's
version.
He's going to be
Beetlejuice.
In it. Right, right. He'll be in DC.
Yes.
But, you know,
is he playing Beetlejuice in DC? Who's he playing in DC? Because the DC one is going on right now, and then they're getting transferred to Broadway. Well, it will happen. By the time this episode comes out, it will be about to open on Broadway, I think.
I don't fucking know.
Blue is affiliated with Beetlejuice. Hard to know.
Okay.
Exactly what
more like
he's doing.
He's also going to be in Kiss Me. He's going to be in Kiss Me Kate on Broadway next year.
I love Corbin Blue too. Whole cast of High School
I think we should all go see Kiss Me Kate on Broadway.
Fine.
Ooh.
In like May of 2019.
Yeah, let's
What's
do
Ashley
that.
What's Ashley Tisdale up to?
Yeah.
She a brunette again?
I feel like she went back to
I
Disney
didn't, is she,
Channel.
Has she been pregnant that many times?
Is she brunette?
Oh, I thought you said, is she pregnant again?
No,
I was
she's
like,
a
geez.
Natural brunette.
Interesting.
I'm pregnancy shaming Ashley Tisdale.
Oh, I don't like that in Wikipedia, under public image, it says, Tisdale is considered a sex symbol. Mm. And then there's a link to sex symbol.
Oh. Is Ashley Tisdale the picture?
A famous person or fictional character widely regarded to be sexually attractive. Here's the picture. It's Marilyn Monroe.
Oh, wow. I've heard of her.
Sorry.
She's commonly associated with sex.
Right. Ashley Tisdale was in some sort of an animated film called Charming.
Look, we're stealing material here because this is the context we're going to need when we do our Kenny Ortega miniseries. So let's just save it.
I love Ortega.
Ortegs.
Newsies.
Newsies.
Hocus Pocus.
God, the dancer who wanted to direct. What a compelling narrative. Yeah.
Newsies is an insane movie.
Yeah, Ortega's
it's
weird.
Insane.
Ortega's weird. He directed the Michael Jackson posthumous concert documentary.
Yeah, he was sort of in with Jackson. I think he did like a lot of Michael Jackson
that
stuff.
That documentary is all
Ortega's
him
got
talking
got
to Michael
great
Jackson.
Great selection of pants.
Yes, he's a very well-dressed man.
He's got the pants on that man, I swear.
He also directed a lot of Gilmore Girls episodes, like a lot.
He did.
Really?
Yes.
So I know him from that.
Okay, so let's, on the record right now, Kenny Ortega is our next miniseries.
He's only got five movies.
Oh, excuse me.
Are three of them High School Musical?
Oh, I guess if you count
theatrical.
The High School Musicals, right.
Yeah, because he still directs a lot of Disney Channel stuff. I mean, he did
he
the two Descendants
the Cheetah
movies.
Girls 2.
Wow,
directed,
the one in Spain.
Yes.
Directed an episode of Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. Directed an episode of Bunheads.
Oh, see.
Bunheads.
He hasn't had a
theatrical release. Yeah, he's in with Amy Sherman-Palladino.
Yeah, he hasn't had a theatrically released movie since Michael Jackson's This Is It. And I guess you could say that was it.
Yep.
Jamie, thank you so much for being here.
Hey, thank you for having me. I love to talk about the boy from Burbank.
The boy from Burbank.
Yeah.
Yep.
So sad.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Yeah, seriously.
On the show.
Oh,
very
no.
Excited
it was great. Thank
you're
you for
you're
me.
In New York for like 24 hours and we.
That's true.
We wanted to make this happen so badly.
We made it happen.
We made it happen.
Success. Right, Ben?
Yes.
Did you remember to hit record, Ben?
Yeah.
Oh, thank God. Okay, phew.
Okay. I had to double check.
But I was really worried about that.
Right, right,
right, right. I love that we both had to take a nap during this movie.
it was rough.
I needed a feature length nap in the middle of the movie.
Same. I finally finished this morning. I had to delay it, actually. Like, I had to go to bed and then finish
a little Dark Shadows breakfast.
I put it on my iPad and I watched it on the subway to my Girl with the Girl in the Spider Web screening. And
dating
from,
this episode. Yeah.
Yeah. The Girl in the Spider Web screening.
Did you like it?
No.
Okay, good.
It's not good.
I haven't seen it.
It's bad.
Which, hacker.
My response.
She. 18 hacking scenes. If you want hacking, she's hacking up the wazoo. But hacking from her phone, like a phone hacking.
Oh.
I don't know.
I'm just very surprised that choosing not to bring back the person who got an Oscar nomination for playing the character was a bad creative choice.
Do you think that they eventually just were like, forget it, we don't want to do it? Or did they genuinely like sort of get cut out of it?
She has said that she wanted to do it and was upset that she didn't get offered.
That's weird.
Rooney Mara didn't even get an offer?
That's
no.
weird.
Because she had the contract, and when Fincher's not doing it, they're doing the fourth book, and she was like in an interview, she's like, I haven't talked to anyone, but I'd like to do it. Then they announced Claire Foy, and she was like, I don't know, they never reached out to me.
The thing that's really weird about the movie
is
that it's based on the fourth book, and the movie essentially is kind of like, you remember what happened in the second and third books, right? And I'm like, I know, I actually never read them. And the movie's like, sure you do. Yeah, she's got like a dad and a sister and shit. And I'm like, I didn't know. And they were like, oh, well, we figured you knew all that, you know, so this makes no sense.
It's so weird. It's just like everyone was like pretty on board with that performance. And then to throw that out,
like
feels
Foy
very...
is at least fine.
She's a good actor.
No, in the movie, she's fine. Yeah. She's not good, but she's fine. But like you went from Daniel Craig to a random Swedish guy. That's the other thing. They just cast a random Swedish guy.
No.
Yeah. And he's like such a wet blanket.
It's the Swedish chef, isn't it?
Yes, it's Swedish chef. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Bjorky Bjork.
Yeah. And Vicky Creeps is in it, but it's before Phantom Thread. Like came out, so they're just sort of like she's in like two scenes and you're like, give me more Creeps.
That's always the weirdest phenomenon when like Lupita Nyong'o is like one of the flight attendants in Nonstop, which was shot before 12 Years a Slave, so by the time the movie comes out she's won an Oscar and her only line is like, and would you like sparkling or still? Like she's on camera a lot but mostly as like a featured extra. Anyway, that's been our boiling hot Girl in the Spiderweb talk that is now being released 5 months after the film has been released.
I'm sorry.
No, burning hot episode. People were waiting for those takes, baby.
Yeah, I mean, it was the Dark Shadows episode, so whatever. Like, we can be as weird as we want,
right?
Yeah,
look,
it's a weird movie.
Hey, look. Family is strange, right? Strange is relative. I fucked it up.
Strange is relative.
Jamie, everyone should listen. Bechdel Cast. Anything else you want to plug for the month of March 2019?
In March? Oh, God. I mean, I'm going to be popping off in March. Just you wait.
Yeah.
Now just listen to the Bechdel Cast. New episodes on Thursday.
Google to figure out what your Twitter account is at that time.
Yeah, hopefully it'll be resolved. I was just rejected today, so.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I'm appealing and appealing.
What a good company. What a great company.
I love that I like so much of like my interaction with people who like this show is tied to that stupid fucking website. Oh, you know what
so
I mean?
You're also like the one person who still kind of enjoys it.
I like Twitter because but I only use it to talk to my friends.
That's what you say. Every time I stress out about Twitter, David just goes like, come on!
Well, I mean,
it's I use it to talk to my friends!
Well, but like,
I ignore all the other stuff. He blocks everything else out.
Right. I'm like an extreme muter. Like, it's mute crazy. And sometimes to the extent that like people will be like, I can't believe it. And I'm like, they can't believe what? I have to like tap through three things to
He like literally mutes anyone who isn't a friend of his.
Yeah,
muted all corporations, all strangers.
I turned off all notifications from people who don't follow me, which really did change my life.
That's the big
That was huge.
Okay.
But because The Atlantic will tweet me out and people will be like, and I was just like, no, goodbye forever. I never want to see this.
David likes it because he's a very funny texter. He's a really good person to text with.
Oh,
he's
thank you.
The king of the Slack threads.
Wow, that's a big compliment.
And,
thank you.
And so like he gets to just have like friend conversations publicly on Twitter and then gets likes for it.
Right.
You know?
You just get to be loved for being yourself.
Right.
And he's literally having conversations with people publicly, and people are like, good writer, good writer.
Right,
like,
funny. You're right. You probably nailed it.
I think that's your entire.
Well, I mean, I'm an incredibly social person in general. So I think like Twitter is just another way for me to like chat to my friends if I'm bored.
David like screams at people if they don't tell him what's going on in their life.
Yeah. I get so mad.
He goes, and like, then, what else?
Yeah. I'm like, what's going on? And they're like, I don't know. And then they're like, what's going on with you? And I'm like, oh, nothing. Oh, right. I don't know.
Yeah. I still don't know his last name. He hasn't told me anything.
It's a secret.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for being here, Jamie.
Hey, thanks for having me.
And thanks so much to all of you for listening. Please remember to rate, review, subscribe. Go to blankiesatriot.com for some real nerdy shit. Go to TeePublic for some real nerdy merchandise. Thanks to Andrew Gudo for our social media, Lane Montgomery for our theme song, Joe Bowen and Pat Reynolds for our artwork. And as always, be like Jack and Sally.
Oh, gross.